are this afternoon. And without further ado, let us proceed with our plenary speaker.
Yes, that's right. We would like to thank all our participants. So right now, let's proceed with our plenary speaker for this afternoon. So here, our plenary speaker is an academic, opinion columnist, and media pundit, as well as policy advisor focusing on the Asia-Pacific region. As an academic, he has taught as political science professor at the Ateneo de Manila University and the La Salle University, and most recently was a research fellow at the National Chang'e University in Taiwan, and has delivered lectures and talks at the world's leading universities, including Columbia University, Stanford University, Harvard University, Johns Hopkins University, Leiden University, the Australian National University, and the National University of Singapore. As an advisor, he has provided consultancy to top government officials, presidential candidate, civil society groups, as well as investment groups, including Deutsche Bank, Morgan Stanley, and Goldman Sachs. He is a regular opinion writer for Al Jazeera English, The Straits Times, Nikkei Asian Review, South China Morning Post, Forbes, and a columnist for the Philippine Daily Inquirer. He is currently a non-resident fellow at Strap-based ADR Institute, a resident political analyst for GMA Network, where he is also the co-host of the Stanford Truth Show, and previously resident foreign affairs analyst for the ABS-CBN News Channel. He is a regular contributor to the Center for Strategic and International Studies and Council on Foreign Relations, and frequently contributes to other leading think tanks across the world. He was awarded as the 10 Outstanding Young Men in the Philippines in 2016, as well as 10 Outstanding Young Persons of the World in 2018 for his contributions to social sciences and public education. As one of the most prominent strategic thinkers in the region, he has authored several books and more than 1,000 articles and columns. He has been described as one of Asia's most prolific young analysts, while the Manila Bulletin has described him as among the country's foremost foreign affairs and economic analysts. Stanford University's Freeman Spogli Institute has described him as the most prolific and interviewed geopolitical analyst currently writing and speaking not only in the Philippines, but arguably in Southeast Asia as well.
Our plenary speaker has also published several scholarly publications. His book, The Rise of Duterte, A Populist Revolt Against Elite Democracy, published by Palgrave Macmillan, was placed on the Financial Times Best of Weekend Long Reads list and has described a suburb monograph on the Duterte phenomenon grounded in political theory and Philippine history, while the Times Literary Supplement described it as an important work which vividly describes the simmering public dissatisfaction with post-Marcos elite democracy that paved the way for Duterte's rapid rise to power. His latest book, also published by Palgrave Macmillan, is The Indo-Pacific, Trump, China, and the New Struggle for Global Mystery. Among his latest of forthcoming academic publications are Penal Populism in Emerging Markets, Human Rights and Democracy in the Age of Strongmen, Politics of the Philippines, From Rizal to Duterte, China's New Empire and Subaltern Populism, Dutertismo and the War on Constitutional Democracy.
He has written for and are interviewed by Al Jazeera English, BBC, Bloomberg, CNN International, CNBC, Christian Science Monitor, Foreign Affairs, Forbes, The New York Times, The Washington Post, The Guardian, The Wall Street Journal, The Financial Times, The Economist, Reuters, USA Today, The Nation, NPR, Spiegel, among other leading global publications and news outlets. As an international affairs expert, he has been consulted by leading global publications such as the Oxford University Press and written major scholarly publications such as Harvard International Review, Asian Security, The Routledge Handbook of Asian Security, Routledge Handbook of Insurgency and Counterinsurgency, the Cairo Review of Global Affairs, among others. Now, let us give a virtual round of applause to our highly distinguished speaker, Professor Richard Havad Haydarian.
Maayong hapon. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yes, maraming salamat. Thank you very much for that very, very extensive introduction. I think I send a shorter version para hindi kayo mapagod. I think nag-spread pa kayo ng labor dyan, no? That is very kind of you. In short, wala siyang social life, no? Yun ang I think implication ng itong introduction na itong tao po ay medyo obsessed po sa kanyang ginagawa. Yeah, just to tell you po, over the past decade or so, I'm a millennial, just to be clear. Hindi po tayo ganun katanda, but you know, throughout my 20s at least, you know, I tried my best po na ma-meet ko po yung mga iba't ibang leaders, pag-aralan po yung mga iba't ibang bansa, kasi madali po magbigay ng opinion, no, about, you know, politics and different persons, but it's really different when you meet, you know, President Duterte, prime ministers from around the world. Yeah, you interview and you talk to a lot of our top leaders. It gives you a certain perspective, no? So ako, I always tried to make sure na pagdating sa akin political analysis, of course, I have my views. I have my own convictions, personal convictions and all. But at the same time, I try to look at the big picture, no? And I think it's also important na hindi ka lang limited into reading, although reading is very, very important, because if you want to write a lot, you have to read a lot. Otherwise, san galing materials mo. But at the same time, you also have to have real life experience, no, real life interaction with people who have to make very tough choices and all, no. So I think on President Duterte alone, although I'm not going to talk about President Duterte that much because this is not going to be a political presentation per se, but a political science kind of presentation. You know, I've written probably what 1,000 on Philippines and President Duterte over the past 5 years. At ito ay dahil marami pong aspeto ng ating politika, no? It's not really black and white all the time. Sometimes it's black and white, but most of the time it's really the shades of gray, 1,000 shades of gray, no? And that's what we're trying to do. So para sa akin, mahalaga na bilang isang scholar, bilang isang estudyante, bilang isang mamamayan, no, na Pilipino, parating bukas yung ating yung pag-iisip, yung ating thinking, to learning from each other. So today is an experience for me to actually to also learn, no, to share some of my views within the next hour or so. Although alam ko masasabaw na kayo at you just had your lunch, so siguro yung iba nagsisiesta na. I hope not. We'll try to keep this as engaging as possible. So I'll try to divide my presentation into two parts. One is to look at the more immediate developments recently and how that tells us a lot about the nature of leadership, especially dito sa 21st century. Sigurado ako na lahat kayo meron kayong ideal, no? No, ano bang dapat isang leader, no? Whether sa level ng corporation, whether sa level of gobyerno, whether sa level ng student organization, or sa loob ng bahay, no? So lahat tayo meron tayong mga biases, may mga ideals that we grow up with from a very young age, no? In fact, there are a lot of studies in neurosciences that show that the way you vote also depends on how you were raised as a person. So siguro kung lumaki ka sa isang bahay na yung meron kang padre de familia na napaka-stricto, it is highly likely that you also develop a sense na authority is someone who's more strong-willed, if not iron-fisted, no? If lumaki ka sa isang bahay na more, more equal yung interaction sa pagitan ng mga parents at saka mga children, it's possible na magiging more liberal ka rin in terms of your voting. So there are a lot of interesting studies on that. But today, I'll try to generally talk about the nature of leadership in the 21st century and whether great leaders can make great difference. And if they can, under what circumstances, right? So I think that is what we're trying to discuss today. I can share my screen, diba? Sorry, I just sent kasi. Okay. All right, na-realize ko na I can share my own screen. One second. Sorry about this. Let me full screen this. Okay. So today, let me discuss about nature of leadership. No, 21st leaders, 21st century leadership. Alam ko, marami sa atin nagbasa ng Biblia, nagbasa Nagbabasa tayo ng kasaysayan. Of course, pinag-aralan natin yung panahon nila Rizal, yung ating founding fathers, Bonifacio, Aguinaldo, among others. So for sure, we have certain ideals about what is leadership. But I would argue this afternoon that 21st century leadership is about developing strong institutions and less of strong men, right? And when we say strong men, it doesn't mean yung malakas na tao. Of course, we need strong people in charge of our government. No one wants to have weak men. But when you say strong men, it means authoritarian leaders who believe that political will alone, that their will alone, will magically solve all the complicated problems that we have in the very globalized world that we have today. No, that we can rule a country like we can rule a barangay or a small city or even a city for that matter. I think that is the kind of leadership that I think is increasingly not going to work in our era because of the complexity of the issues and problems that we're facing today. Nonetheless, generally, there have been a long debate about ano ba talaga isang good leader. So, on the one hand, meron tayong notion ng great man of history. No, if you really want to understand where this theory came from, alam ko sa atin mga Pilipino, instinctive yan. No? Meron tayong idea ng malakas na leader and all of that. But actually, there's a very long history of writings by very prominent writers on that. No, among them, of course, is Thomas Carlyle. No? In his essays, series of essays that he presented in Scotland, and eventually it actually turned into a book entitled On Heroes, Hero Worship, and the Heroic in History. No? So this is a very, very important work in the whole literature on the so-called great man of history. And of course, on the left side, you can see the picture of Napoleon Bonaparte on his white steed, and you know, essentially, you could see in that picture alone that it seems like one man in his vision and in his grip has the future of human history. No, so yun yung impression na meron tayo. And I think Thomas Carlyle has written extremely eloquent works on the importance of not only generals and politicians but also prophets. Of course, if you look at their history, Jesus Christ had a huge impact on world history, not only on Christians, but also on non-Christian societies. No, at the end of the day, even the Roman Empire eventually had to accept Christianity. So that is the power of the word. No, that is the power of prophetic revelation. No, in the case of Jesus Christ, Muslims also, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, he changed the history of his people in Mecca and Arabia, and eventually, from his small, from relatively small areas of Arabia, Islam was able to spread and eventually conquer the Persian and the Roman empires, huge parts of the Byzantinian empires. And at one point in history, around 600-800 years ago, the Islamic empires were biggest in the world, extending from Spain and Portugal all the way to Central Asia and India, right? So that cannot be understood without understanding the impact of great men or women, for that matter. Catherine the Great of Russia played a very, very important role on modernizing Russia and bringing it into the modern era. So by the time of Catherine the Great in the mid-18th century, Russia became one of the world major powers in ways that it was not just a few generations ago. So women and men, great men and women can indeed make a big difference. And as Thomas Carlyle said, no great man, unfortunately back then, walang feminism masyado, so walang masyadong sensitivity. But I think generally when you say man here, you're talking about human beings, not just men. No great human lives in vain. The history of the world is but the biography of great human beings or men, as Thomas Carlyle put it. And I think that quote, in one version or the other, has very much influenced us, our political discourse, and also subliminally, the idea that if we have one strong leader, one good president, one good mayor, everything could be solved. All the problems of hundreds of years of poverty, of corruption could be solved by one man. So that goes to the works of people like Thomas Carlyle, right? And this has influenced both Western literature and us non-Western countries. We are very much more, in tune with authoritarian leaders because the history of democracy is relatively young in non-Western societies. Or you could say it's also young in the Western societies, although they had some ancient experiences like the time of Athens in Greece. Now, That is the one side of the debate. But there's another side of the debate put forward by, I think, best person who was really behind this was Leo Tolstoy, right? Count Leo Tolstoy. You may be familiar with some of his works. Popular works of his are Anna Karenina. So I think there was a movie of that a few years ago. Not bad. The movie is not bad. I would suggest you check the movie, Anna Karenina. You know, his books are like 1,000 page long. So I have two of them at the back of me. I read them yung may Baguio dat sa Manila and Baguio and all. So I would just sit at home 3, 4, 5 days and go through the entire novel. And with notes and highlights and all of that, right? Because these are not just novels, but these are reflections on the on human nature. These are reflections on the nature of human societies. Now, if you look at his work, War and Peace, if you bother to read at least the opening parts of the War and Peace, especially this very good translation by the translator couples, Richard Pefkar and Larissa Wolokonski. If you look at it, in the opening parts, Tolstoy talks about Napoleon, because the War and Peace was set actually during the Napoleonic War. So in many ways, it is a direct criticism of works by people like Carlyle, right? So it's a novel set during the era of Napoleon, when Napoleon conquers most of Europe and is about to conquer Russia. But what Tolstoy argues and very eloquently explains and narrates and describes in his novel is that sometimes we think it's really one man calling the show, but he's really just the tip of the iceberg, right? He's just really a cog in a bigger machine, to use the term of Max Weber, right? And it's just that we can see only that one person because he's the most famous, he's the face of a movement. But for him, without the Grand Army of France, without millions of French individuals volunteering, and tearing conscription, France would not have been able to expand the way that Napoleon was able to, right? So Napoleon owes the success of his military campaign in as much to perhaps his personal vision and ambition, but also to millions of soldiers who are willing to risk their life for Mother France, for the ideals of the French Revolution. So to say that Napoleon alone is responsible for everything great that happened on the battlefield, that misses the point. In fact, Napoleon himself, he has one of his very interesting quotes. I mean, there are many quotes attributed to him, but one of the most interesting quotes is that essentially he says that luck is very important in the battlefield. His idea is that to succeed in the battlefield, you just have to make fewer mistakes than the other side. And I would argue that you have to have soldiers who are more willing to die than the other side. And that's exactly what happened under Napoleon. So while Napoleon, in many ways, could be described as a tactical genius, right? Or maybe not, depending on whose analysis you look at, his success would not have been possible had he not been a leader of a country like France on the throes of revolutionary upheaval, right? If you're actually familiar with history, Napoleon is actually not quote-unquote French. He's actually Corsican. And if you look at Corsica, which is a part of France, in the Mediterranean island, which wants to separate from France, they're actually more Italian than the French. So Napoleon is, you would say ethnically, perhaps race is not the correct term, but he's more Italian than French. But that's besides the point. The case here is that had Napoleon not been born in somewhere like France, let's say he was born in some random colony or second-rate power, I don't think we would have known Napoleon at all. So that brings me to the third perspective, which is a dialectical perspective put forward by no less than Karl Marx in his work, The 18th Brumaire of Louis Bonaparte, which is, of course, a reflection on Napoleon Bonaparte III, no, the nephew of Napoleon, who will come into force in France in the middle of the 19th century. No, and he's very much responsible, together with Haussmann, into making Paris the beautiful city that it is today. No. Now, again, I hope hindi tayo maretag dito. This is not an endorsement of Karl Marx and Marxism, but Marx was a very, very incisive thinker, right? So you may disagree with his political project, you may disagree with communism and all the adulterated interpretations and misinterpretation of his works, but he had some very interesting and almost poetic observations on human nature. In that work, The 18th Brumaire of Louis Bonaparte, he says, men make their own history, but they do not make it as they please. They do not make it under self-selected circumstances, but under circumstances existing already, given and transmitted from the past. In short, you do not arrive at a blank canvas. And it depends what kind of society and circumstances you are born into and what circumstances you rise to power. That is extremely, extremely important. Many of people who turn up as presidents, perhaps they had no chance of becoming the presidents had they run in a different era or in different election cycle. So circumstances and timing is very, very important. And what we're going to try to do later today is to understand what do we mean by circumstances. And that is where institutions become very, very important, although we Filipinos tend to always talk about culture, 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 culture. But I'll discuss how that is a very simplistic, if not problematic, way of looking at how, what are the roots of our problems and how we can make the Philippines a more successful country in the 21st century. Now, just for us to have a better understanding of everything, you know, the past week or so, obviously, unless you have been living in a cave or I don't know, you would have noticed that something big happened. It happened thousands of miles away from our country, but it has reverberated in the global consciousness and likely will go down as one of the major events in the early 21st century, right? And that was the fall of Kabul over the weekend, the shocking and stunning fall of Kabul. And as I kind of try to paraphrase what Mark Twain, the American writer, said, he said, history doesn't repeat itself, but it rhymes. But in this case, it seems the history almost repeated itself. And I think if you look at it, it's quite shocking also because Biden kept on saying that Afghanistan will not be another Saigon. He kept on saying that. And of course, Biden is not a very young guy. He has been in politics for a very long time. Vietnam era pa lang, he was entering politics. He was one of the youngest senators in U.S. history. I think he was the youngest senator in history. At the age of, I think, 29, he became a senator already. So he's very familiar with history. And in some surreal twist of events, what happened in Kabul almost exactly, it looks like what happened in Saigon, in South Vietnam, in 1975. So as you may be familiar with history, there was North Vietnam and South Vietnam after Second World War. So in the past, there was colonial Vietnam, which was colonized by France, Indochine. And then the North Vietnam communist elements were able to kick out the French. But the Americans later on will come to the assistance of Catholic-dominated South Vietnam, right? Diem regime. And that regime, similar to Afghanistan, will be under American patronage for almost two decades. But once the Americans withdraw, immediately the whole thing falls apart. And the North Vietnamese forces would come and conquer Saigon in 1975. Now, of course, I'm not saying that Taliban is the same as the communist North Vietnamese forces. There's a huge, huge difference. I have a lot of respect for what's happening in Vietnam. I may not agree with their authoritarian system and all, but the level of economic prosperity and relative social freedoms that Vietnamese enjoy today is admirable, right? And even if, I'll discuss later on, even if you look at their management of the crisis so far, it has been among the better countries. Despite the fact that in recent weeks, unfortunately, the COVID cases in Vietnam have been going high. But if you look at total cases in Vietnam over the past 12 to 16 months, it's one of the lowest, right, in the world, right? And in fact, their economy grew last year. Their economy expanded last year while the Philippine economy contracted by 10%, right? So Taliban is not, communist regime of Vietnam. But in both cases, the U.S. was absolutely humiliated. In both cases, the United States expected perhaps, as more especially in Afghanistan, that its favored clients, right, would last longer. I mean, U.S. intelligence said up until June that at least, no, 3 to 6 months magsasurvive yung government Afghanistan were the U.S. to fully pull out. No, some other estimates would even put it at a longer period, right? Some were expecting 3 to 5 years perhaps even. No, and yet we saw within a matter of days, no, in fact, all major cities fell. Kandahar, Mazar-e-Sharif, Herat, and over the last weekend, even Kabul fell without even a fight. That was shocking.
And just 5 weeks ago, Biden was saying, oh, Vietnam is not going to happen. Taliban is not going to take over the entire country. Well, guess what? Taliban now controls more territory today in Afghanistan than it did back in 2001, no? Prior to being toppled by Americans following the 9/11 attacks. Now, why am I talking about this? Of course, I'm talking about this because it's very important. It's something that it resonates geopolitically and psychologically and emotionally, looking at the horrible, horrible tragedy that has happened in Afghanistan, and it's and more unfortunate things could happen in the coming weeks and months in Afghanistan as Taliban forces go after women, go after people who work with the Americans, go after former generals, anyone who worked with the former government. You know, we hope the violence will not escalate, but things are not really looking good on the ground there in Afghanistan. But, you know, this also has huge, huge, I think, it carries huge, huge political lessons, no? Because as Americans and Biden put it consistently, I mean, Afghanistan, what? America spent $1 trillion there. Some estimates actually put it at $2 trillion. Joseph Stiglitz, among other economists, have done a lot of calculations on this. $85 billion was spent on Afghan forces. They had 300,000 forces, right? And yet they just melted away. I mean, that how is that even possible? And I think that says a lot about importance of institutions and, of course, also the importance of leadership, right? So if you want to understand success, you have to understand failure. And what happened in Afghanistan was a spectacular failure that has huge lessons for humanity and for leadership and governance in the 21st century, right? Especially as we deal with this pandemic and who knows what else can come, right? We have climate change, we have technological disruption. God forbid, there could be more pandemics on the horizon as climate change also kicks in, because hotter climate can create more mutations, more problems. So in short, what is happening in Afghanistan, it's not something that just happens there, no? And naligtas na natin yung FWs natin, forget about that country. No, it tells us a lot about the physics of power in the 21st century. And let's briefly go to what happened in Afghanistan so that I can show to you what is the relevance of what is happening there. You know? So this is a picture over the weekend of these people. I mean, just look at these guys. I mean, do they look like the people who you think could have defeated a 300,000 strong military trained by Americans with Humvees, helicopters, fighter jets? And yet they did it. I mean, this is them taking selfies, taking pictures, having a good time. You know, there was a lot of memes and spoofs about what happened. But I mean, look at these guys. I mean, I'm not sure where they came from. You know, you can make a lot of other comments that I'd rather not make here in the public. And yet, you know, they won. They beat them. Just weeks ago, people were talking about we were talking about these great star generals of Afghanistan, like Mr. Sami Sadat. They were saying, I mean, this guy, Sami Sadat, really has an impressive CV, right? Trained in London's King's College, trained in NATO, in America, different places. You know, he was a national security advisor. So he was an all-around guy, you know, kind of a young Napoleon. And yet, you know, he was not able to hold the country together. And from the latest news I get, you know, General Sadat is now among the resistance forces in Panjshir, in the northern areas of Afghanistan. Now, if you look at it also, the president of Afghanistan, Mr. Ghani, who escaped to United Arab Emirates, the rumor is that he took $165 million with him, and now he's given humanitarian assist refuge in United Arab Emirates, so he's going to have a good life perhaps there in Dubai. This guy, not long ago, I mean, this is just unbelievable. Look at the biography of this guy. He was ranked number 2 global thinker by the Prospect magazine, but in the United Kingdom, less than a decade ago. This was just shortly before he became the president. He was the finance minister. This is a guy who took his PhD in Columbia University in the US. He was a professor at Johns Hopkins University. He worked at the World Bank. He is a specialist on failed states and how to make modern states. That is his specialization, right? And yet, the guy just completely fumbled it. He could not mobilize the forces. He could not bring together warlords. And ignominiously, he just abandoned his people, 48 hours after reassuring them that he'll stay with them till the end. He didn't. He just escaped. So it's really shocking to see that the Afghan government actually was not short of stars. I mean, it had great Western-trained generals like General Sami Sadat. It had one of the world's most celebrated intellectuals, like someone like Mr. Ashraf Ghani. I'm not saying all intellectuals are like him. I can cite you a lot of intellectuals who will fight and are brave, but I mean, it's just shocking to see that the Afghan government was not occupied by a bunch of nobodies. There were a lot of somebodies there, right? A lot of stars there. And yet the whole thing just collapsed, right? I mean, this is a picture of the Afghan military. I mean, look at it. They have Humvees. They're well-armed. I mean, they have their equipment looks like American troops. And yet, you know, they lost to these guys, you know? And how is that even possible? You know, this is the Afghan military that the Americans train. I mean, look at it. It's a modern military, right? It's even larger than the Philippine military. Our annual budget is barely $2 billion on our military. And these guys had $85 billion spent on them by conservative estimates, right? And yet, they lost to these guys, Taliban. I mean, look at it. These Taliban guys get into the presidential palace and all. They see modern gyms probably for the first time. And now you see they're using these bomb cars. They're trying to figure out how to use these dumbbells and everything inside the gym. These guys beat these guys. I mean, how is that even possible, right? So, you know, this is a case study. This is a really a case study that we'll have to go back to over and over and over again throughout the years to understand what the hell happened in Afghanistan. Because then again, this has implications. I mean, this is what Biden said the other day. American troops cannot and should not be fighting in a war and dying in a war that Afghan forces are not willing to fight for themselves. U.S. President Joe Biden says Afghanistan leaders were given every tool they could need to face the Taliban. In a way, he's right. They had all of this to face this, and yet they fell apart. Now, obviously, I disagree with Biden that there was not will to fight. There was a will to fight. In fact, if you look at the numbers that came out by Nikkei Asia, among others, 69,000 Afghan military, soldier, personnel, security forces, and policemen died over the past decade or so fighting for their country. Right? So to say they did not have a will to fight is nonsense. But why did the whole thing fall apart like a house of cards, as one Russian newspaper put it, with Schadenfreude, once the Americans were not even complete with their pullout, right? That is the question. And of course, when you have failure of leadership, when you have incompetent leadership, when you have coward leadership, right? People suffer. Ordinary people suffer. Innocent people suffer, right? These are the pictures we have been seeing in Afghanistan over the past few days. And the latest one I'm seeing are really horrible. I mean, we see pictures of toddlers being passed over the walls to American soldiers to get them into the airport. Afghans are not able to get to the airport. They're being blocked, especially those who used to work for the government. Taliban is looking for former collaborators. They go house to house. They have the list, meron silang list, parang drug list ni Duterte sila, may list naman sila for the you know, for their enemies. And if you do not surrender, they're going to go after your family. So these are really horrible times. So failure of leadership, despite having stars, means even if you have the most advanced, you can lose to this and this happens, right? So leadership matters. Leadership matters. But even more important than leadership is institutions. So you need leaders who build institutions. That is the leadership. We need strong leaders who build strong institutions. Now, Mr. Ghani, he was just happy being there in Kabul, right? Calling the shots, but he didn't bother to go on the ground and build coalitions and get help and bring the country together. He was snub. He didn't bother to meet a lot of tribal leaders. So guess what happened? A lot of these leaders, governors, they just defected to Taliban. That's why Taliban won. Taliban won without even fighting over the past week or so. Because everyone defected away from Ghani, who was haughty and almighty there in Kabul, giving orders, not meeting people, snubbing them. And that's what happens. The whole thing fell apart. So there was a really interesting article on the mystery of Afghanistan's missing military leaders. And these are some of the very good findings I have found there. So what went wrong? There was not lack of political will per se. As we saw, 69,000 Afghan troops and police forces died over the past decade or so. They sacrificed for their country. a lot of top government officials were assassinated by Taliban up until last week, right? They still stood there. A lot of female, women, and minority group, Hazara, Uzbek, Tajik, Afghans, joined the national government even though they knew they would be targets of Taliban for assassination and now, who knows, worse, execution probably. And yet they were there. There was political will. What was not there was institutional coherence and multi-level competent leadership in the darkest hour. It is one thing to have a great leader on the top, which Afghanistan apparently didn't even have. It is good to have a great general at the very top to head your special command forces. But you need leaders at every level of governance and military organization. Dapat yung head ng platoon mo. Dapat yung head ng brigade mo. Dapat yung head ng department mo. Dapat yung national defense secretary mo. Lahat sila dapat competent for this to work. Kung one lang yung competent or dalawa, and then ang daming mga scalawags dyan, the system will not work, right? The system will not work because you need multi-level, competent, good leadership. And for that to happen, you need to have institutions that can regularly produce and promote good leaders and at the same time demote and kick out bad, incompetent, corrupt leaders. So we are not Afghanistan, sure, but I'm sure you can see some parallels, right? And some relevance that what happened in Afghanistan as an extreme case to a poor developing countries like the Philippines, which is also struggling against corruption, incompetence, and among others. That is why what happens in Afghanistan is relevant for us if you want to study leadership and governance. So one of the criticisms was that Americans gave all of these weapons. They gave these Humvees, helicopters, fighter jets, all these nice guns, armors. They brought them to America, to NATO, trained them, so on and so forth. So there was a lot of emphasis on individual mentorship. So, oy, magaling ito, parang sa basketball. I-train natin yan. Pero pinabayaan yung buong basketball academy, right? So the U.S. never built institutions that produce a lot of good leaders on multiple levels. Hindi lang yung mga star generals, but on multiple levels. Hindi naman lahat pwede galing sa America around the world to train, right? Maybe 500 at most or 1,000. But you need to have tens of thousands of good leaders on so many levels for the whole system to work. I hope you get the relevance of what I'm trying to say here. So the root cause was a lack of sufficient and effective institutions, right? To hold the country together in the darkest hours. So as soon as Ghani left, the whole thing fell apart. The whole thing fell apart. As soon as Ghani, the president there, was inefficient in bringing warlords together to defend the country, to rally the forces, the whole thing fell apart. And even Sami Sadat, you know, despite being a great commander, at the end of the day, there was so much he could do. And he's not a coward, as far as we know. He is now among the resistant forces, right? So probably we're going to hear more from him. Hopefully we'll hear more from him. But at the end of the day, you needed political leadership. But you also needed, even more importantly, strong institutions that will hold the country together and not just rely on one leader or two, right? For the whole show to run, right? It's like having a movie that you only have one big star, ang ganda ng plot niya, and then everyone has bad plots. And then if biglang nagkasakit or something yung artist mo, yung actor mo, wala, the whole film will fall apart. But if you gave good script and good roles to a lot of secondary and third level characters, even though wala na yung primary character mo, the whole plot can still move forward, right? And I think that's the beauty of some of the works like, you know, like Game of Thrones, right? There may be a star or two protagonists, but there are many other secondary, tertiary characters that hold the story together. So just like in the movie, kung umasa ka lang sa isa lang na character at biglang namatay yan or something, the whole thing falls apart. The same thing also in politics and governance. So you need to have a good plot that gives good script to many, many secondary and tertiary also characters. So I hope you can see the metaphor of what I'm trying to do here, right? Because if this were just about one person or two, you see the risk, right? Once that person is gone or that person suddenly cowers, the whole thing falls apart like a house of cards. Now, if you want a much more detailed understanding of history of Afghanistan and everything like that, but in a compressed way, you can check my Esquire magazine essay this week where I discuss the roots of the problem. So hindi ito nagsimula ng 2001 when nag-invade ang America, pwede tayo bumalik actually back in the Cold War era when Soviet Union invaded Afghanistan and then US supported Mujahideen fighters, some of them turned out to be Taliban. So, you know, twists and turns of history. No? Now, even in the pandemic, if you look at it, okay, of course, I know some people are saying, oh, but look at Taiwan now and Vietnam, they have high cases because of Delta. That's true. And as you know, Vietnam has had a problem over the past few months because ayaw nila mag-import ng Chinese vaccine. They don't believe in Chinese vaccines and they don't want to be dependent on China. But because they didn't import a lot of Chinese vaccines, there's a kind of shortage of vaccines, and Vietnam is having a problem with the spike in Delta cases. Nonetheless, look at the total cases in Vietnam over the past 18 months. It's among the lowest on earth. And Vietnam's economy has been growing. Wala silang recession, wala silang contraction. Unlike in the Philippines when we had 5 quarters of contraction, right? From first quarter of last year until first quarter of this year, right? Vietnam has been growing. Taiwan, again, there has been a spike. And as you know, Taiwan is not an independent country fully in a sense that there's a one China policy. Us, for instance, we recognize Beijing, not Taipei as the representative of China. So Taiwan had some problems with buying vaccines and all and sourcing them. There has been a spike in cases because of slow vaccine rollout. But again, overall, look at the number of cases in Taiwan and Vietnam. Look at the casualties. Look at the critical cases. It's very, very low. It's among the lowest in the world. And by the way, Taiwan also grew its economy last year. And if you look at all of these countries, their success, overall success, maybe not in the past few weeks, but their overall success, because you have to look at the total numbers and have a longitudinal analysis, is a product of three elements. State capacity, meaning they had strong institutions. Their Department of Health was not corruption riddled. Their Department of Health was not led by incompetent, corrupt people, right? Their Department of Health could do effective contact tracing. Their Department of Health could go on the ground and actually, contact trace. And if there's someone who has been exposed, they can isolate that person. So they had efficient departments of health, national police force, among others, to ensure that hindi masyado mag-spread yung virus over the past year or so. And then social cohesion. There's also a high level of trust in among Taiwanese people and Vietnamese people in their government. Very high levels of trust. Because their governments are not corrupt, they're not incompetent. You know, in the case of Taiwan, it's a very democratically elected government. So there's cohesion, there's public trust, there's social capital and trust among citizens. So they cooperate. I was actually in Vietnam last year. No, so I was there March last year. So as lockdowns were coming in, I saw in Vietnam, you know, life was going on. You know, people would put masks, they would do their thing, but life goes on. And there were no police, there was no military, walang lockdown in the strict way that we see here in the Philippines, wala, you know. And this generally worked up until recently na nagkaroon ng Delta, no? Yeah, so, you know, to judge them on what happened in the past month and forget about all the 12, 16 months of success is just nonsense, right? And then stewardship, of course, their leader stepped up to the plate. And I'm not talking about only the presidents. I'm talking about the heads of their Department of Health. I'm talking about the heads of their different government agencies in charge of dealing with the pandemic. All of them step up to the plate when the going went tough, right? So all these three elements will come together for you to have a successful management of an unprecedented one in a century crisis like that we have, which is the pandemic COVID-19. So I'm just going to keep it here. Let's take a break, John, no? Because there's a second part, which is a longer part, and alam ko medyo masabaw na kayo. And I believe that. So I'm going to talk about also misconceptions about leadership and development. Medyo longer pa to, but I'll try to skip through it. My slides are like, I think 101 last time I checked. Okay. But I'm going to skip through that. So I'm going to compress the next part of my presentations into around 30 to 40 minutes. And then we can go ahead to question and answer. So I really look forward to mga question and answer niyo because, you know, I mean, hindi naman madali to give a lecture, but and I can go on giving a monologue here. But I think we learn more from each other, including me learning from you guys, if we have some interesting questions and discussions about this. No, but I just felt that we really have to talk about the case of Afghanistan because it's a spectacular failure of supposedly competent, well-funded leaders against a medieval-looking organization like this, right? And I think that tells us a lot about how leadership should work in the 21st century, right? Mm-hmm. Okay, so let's keep it there. Let's take a break. Siguro we can come out back around 2:05. Is that okay, John? Can you hear me? Yeah, medyo mag-break lang tayo because I know medyo sabaw tayo. And then we can continue with our lecture for another 40, 45 minutes. Then go to our presentations. Is that okay?
Yes po, Professor. Wala pong problema po.
Andiyan pa kayo? Okay. Sige, I just want to make sure na hindi ako, I'm not talking to the screen myself. Sige, Ian and so let's take a break, mga 10 minutes, no? So balik tayo ng 2:05. Sige, salamat ha. So let's just take a break.
Sige po, thank you po.
Yeah, okay, please po. Tsaka magkape kayo para di kayo mag-talk at tsaka mag-usap tayo mamaya, press conference style. Sige.
Sige salamat. Po, salamat po.
Yeah, talk to you shortly. Sige, let's just ano na lang the screen.
Okay, for our dear participants, we'll resume at 2:05. So stay back, stay put, relax, and take a break while waiting for 2:05. Thank you.
Shall we start shortly?
Sure, po.
All right, sige po. I hope you took some break. My discussion pa tayo. I'll try to make it as simple as possible, no? I mean, how I wish I could speak Bisaya, no? Because the reason I speak in vernacular is because alam ko minsan pag ginawa mong English parang komplikado, pero sa totoo lang, they're not actually that complicated. I think the problem with a lot of scholars, academics is either A, they really don't know what they're talking about kaya hindi nila ma-simplify, or B, sinasadya nila na i-complicate para mukha silang matalino, no? So I think the job of a really good teacher, a scholar, no, and a thinker is to really go back and really extract the essence of an issue, no? So I really try to simplify to you a very big complicated issue, no? As I said, I mean, the good thing is I've written extensively on all of these issues, so you can always look at the details and references and all. But what I'm presenting you here is kumbaga a snapshot, no, at saka yung big picture dynamics. At the end of the day, what I hope after this lecture and presentation is you go and think for yourself, no? That's what I always do with my students. I mean, ako ay isang produkto ng ako ay isang scholar ng bayan. So I am product of State University. Kaya ang training talaga sa amin is critical thinking for yourself, right? Ayoko mag-spoon feed, no? But at the same time, of course, I have to help you with developing your frameworks and all. So you don't be intimidated. This is something that all of us can relate to dahil malaki pong implication na ito for us as human beings, but also as Filipinos bilang mga mamamayan who are going to vote next year. So this is not about endorsing against or for anyone. This is just about making sure we know how a country is supposed to be run, you know, in the 21st century. So that's the issue. Now, let me go now to my presentation. Yeah, so just to go back to my point a while ago na sabi ko, nagdi-disagree talaga ako kay Biden is this. I mean, just, my God, I mean, just look at these numbers, no? The numbers are horrific. You know, you see, 69,000, almost 70,000 national military and police forces in Afghanistan have died over the past 20 years under American rule. So yes, Americans have died. I mean, there were 3,000 American contractors, 2,000. But I mean, look at the number of sacrifices made by the Afghans themselves. Not to mention, of course, other people, journalists, humanitarian workers, civilians, 50,000 civilians. In fact, more troops died than even civilians. So for anyone to say na, you know, walang willpower ang Afghan forces and all, I mean, they don't know what they're talking about. What they really don't realize is this. You can have everything, but if you don't have a central, it's like, meron kang computer and everything, pero wala kang operating system, no? Walang silbi. Kahit ang ganda ng CPU mo, kahit ang ganda ng hardware mo, no? Kung wala kang operating system, software, the hardware will not work. So there was the hardware, there was the willpower and everything. But there were no coherent institutions that will hold the whole country together. So that is why you cannot assess the success of a country or a project or the quality of governance by just looking at just numbers. You also have to look at also quality. You also have to look at governance, right? And the sad thing is, as we see in Afghanistan, while ordinary soldiers and policemen were willing to die in tens of thousands, their president was a coward who just chose to escape, and we don't know how much money he stole along the way, right? So that's the problem too. Kahit napakagaling yung mga doctors, civil servants, yung mga nagtatrabaho sa Department of Health, no? If all of them are doing their good job, which they are doing. Dito sa Pilipinas, my experience of working in the government in the past, of working with folks in the government, ang dami pong magaling sa ating gobyerno, sa Department of Health, sa Department of Education, among others. Pero kung yung pinaka-leadership or yung mga mid-leadership po, they're not doing their job, they're not standing up, they're not stepping up to the plate, to the challenge, then unfortunately the whole institutions could suffer, no? So yun yung sinasabi natin, because the reality is that almost all the time ordinary civil servants, right, ordinary soldiers, napaka, they really love their country and they're doing their best. And ako bilang isang Pilipino, I can relate to that because I know that's also the reality in our country. Parating natin sinasabi corrupt ang government and all, but let's be very real. You know, this is not like all of them in the government are problem. There are many people in government, perhaps vast majority of people in the government who are just doing their job and helping the country, you know, Department of Education, Department of Health, so on and so forth. So I think that is what we have to keep in mind. Nonetheless, why am I having a hard time? Sorry, mission nag-load problem siya. Okay, now let me just quickly go through this in the next 60 slides. Let me talk to John. Baka siguro pwede i-share yung slides later on. Kasi the purpose here is not to give, I mean, this is a course taught in a whole semester, no? So na-compress ko po siya within an hour. So that's not gonna work if I'm gonna pretend that we can go deep. But I'm just gonna give you a general idea of how to have a more accurate perspective of how things should work in the 21st century. No? Zoom this out a bit. Medyo. Naglalag siya ng konti. Okay, let me just put it this way. Sorry. Sa daming file din yata sa computer ko, naghang to. Okay, so ito. One thing we keep on hearing dito sa Pilipinas is, itong nangyari sa, even in Afghanistan, yung argument ng culture. Kasi pangit ang culture nila, hindi sila united, hindi sila ganito, hindi nila mahal yung bansa nila. So ang solusyon, mahalin mo yung bansa mo. But that's, I don't know, I mean, that's a very shallow way of trying to understand the problem. I mean, let me just give you an idea. All right, if you want to talk about culture, look at Korea, right? If you think about Korea today, what do you think, right? Actually, you would think of two extreme things. Perhaps the first thing that will come to mind is South Korea, right? Which is technology, K-pop, woo, amazing, right? I mean, at least that's the image of South Korea. Although, you know, if you have lived in South Korea, you know, life is very hard there. They'll work you till the end, right? And then there's another Korea, which I also visited, right? North Korea. So if you have been to North Korea, they're effectively same people. Same culture, same race, same language. Siguro iba lang yung accent ng konti at mas masarap yung vegetables nila in North Korea, right? Maybe that's it. No, although unfortunately, you know, I mean, of course, when I was in North Korea, kami guest kami, so they gave us the best. But I know the reality for majority of North Korean is really, really horrible, right? So you have one, essentially, one race, one culture, but because one side of the culture, one side of the country, peninsula in this case, adopted certain policies, no? More freedom, more democracy, more capitalism. And then the other one adopted Stalinism, dictatorship. We can see that same people can have completely different outcomes, no? If they adopt different policies and styles of leadership. So you see the importance of institutions. So in South Korea, they develop inclusive democratic institutions and an open economy, right? In North Korea, it's the opposite. Now the interesting thing is, if you were looking at Korea in 1950s when the war started, the Korean War started, you would bet on North Korea. In fact, North Korea conquered South Korea all the way until Busan, which is the south part of North Korea, of South Korea, until the Americans supported South Korea and pushed them back. So North Korea was actually more developed and powerful than South Korea 60 years ago. And yet we can see the transformation over the past 60 years. That South Korea, which was poorer than the Philippines in 1950s and 60s. So if you look at the stories back in the days, Koreans will study the Philippines in the 50s and 60s on how to become successful. So by the 1970s, while we went to martial law, they were also already building Samsung and Hyundai and LG into global brands that we know today, right? And today we see the huge difference between South Korea and many of its neighbors, including the Philippines, right? So if you just want to reduce it to culture, that is very, very problematic because we can look at countries with exactly the same race, culture, and everything in a very different trajectory. I'll give you another example. Germany, right? Again, think about Germany. Of course, unfortunately, some of you may think of Hitler and all of that, but Hitler was not even German. He was Austrian, but that's a different story. But if you look at Germany, of course, Benz, Audi, fantastic cars, everything like that, no? But if you have been to Germany, what you'll notice is that Germany is very unequal. In a sense that Eastern Germany, which used to be socialist, a socialist republic tied to the Soviet Union during the Cold War, is less developed than West Germany. And if you look at the new Nazi groups, a lot of racist groups, no, in Germany, they tend to come from the Eastern portions, which used to come from the less developed communist Stalinist part of Germany. So you can go... So there's no one Germany. Today's Germany is a reunified Germany of two different Germanies, West Germany and East Germany. And still, despite 30 years of integration since 1989, despite the best efforts of West Germany to help East Germany, you know, despite even though same race sila and everything, Because in the past, iba yung policies, iba yung governance style ng East Germany, up until today, they're hunted by it. So what happens in the past, if you really have bad leadership at some point in your history, it can haunt you for a very, very long time. Again, you can see the implication of that for countries like the Philippines, right? So this is the problem. So the idea that culture explains development, that culture explains success, really actually goes back to Max Weber, who, by the way, was a German sociologist and political economist at the beginning of the 20th century. I really admire the guy. I think he was a brilliant guy. I love his writings, among other things, but he was wrong. He was absolutely wrong on one issue. Because in his book, The Protestant Ethic and the Spirit of Capitalism in 1905, he laid down the foundation of an argument that up until today influences us consciously or subconsciously. He argued back in the day that Protestant countries tend to be more successful capitalist countries because Protestant societies emphasize success in the material world as a sign of blessing of God. And in contrast, Catholic countries, which emphasize the hereafter, the next world, and they denigrate supposedly material success, they tend to be less successful than Protestant countries. More interestingly, he had succeeding works whereby he talked about Eastern countries, Confucian countries. And he said that Confucian countries tend to be passive, and their passivity and lack of proactiveness will explain why these countries will remain as underdeveloped. Problem. First problem is very factual, right? If you look at it, there are many Catholic majority countries today which are as rich, if not more developed, than a lot of Protestant countries. I mean, just look at, for instance, France or Belgium, right? Which are Catholic majority countries, but they're very wealthy developed countries, right? More or less at par with Protestant majority countries like the United States or Germany, right? You also had former Catholic majority countries, which used to be very poor, right? Portugal and Spain. But since their accession to the European Union in the 1970s, if you go to Spain today, it's a very developed place, right? It's one of the richest countries on earth. And Spain is now even more developed than Italy. And Italy, a Catholic majority country, sure. But within Italy, there are a lot of big differences. If you go to the south of Italy, in Sicily area, all the way to Naples, that's where the mafia and all of this stereotypes about Italians come into picture. But if you go to the north of Italy, Lombardy region and all, Milan, those areas, these are one of the most developed and richest areas on earth. Where on earth do you think that Gucci comes from? Where on earth do you think that Ferraris come from? Lamborghinis, all of these state-of-the-art, beautiful aesthetic works of industrial genius, they come from northern Italy, which is, by the way, a Catholic area. So to say that Protestants are inherently going to be more successful because of certain cultural traits misses the point, because there are also Catholic countries which are able to imbibe certain innovation principles and values that made them more developed, right? And, you know, Latin America, Philippines were Catholic majority countries too, but some of us are clearly more developed than others. For instance, Chile is in Latin America, but is far more developed than most of its old Catholic majority peers. So just to reduce it to religion seems to miss the point, because religion is a complicated issue and religion gets to get reinterpreted over and over again. So our Filipino Catholicism today is different from Rizal's era of Catholicism. So if you read the books of Rizal, El Filibisterismo especially, even more than Nolimi Tangere, you would think that Catholicism is such a reactionary kind of religion. But if today, if you look at how we Filipinos understand Catholicism and how we Filipinos stand on issues, social issues, it is not reactionary at all. We are very progressive. We care about human rights. We care about democracy and all. So even Catholicism and the stance of the Catholic Church on many issues has evolved over time. Just look at Pope Francis and the statements he has made on many issues, on climate change, on capitalism, on LGBTQ rights, so on and so forth, right? Even on atheism, right? So religions evolve. Cultures evolve along with religious interpretations. And as far as Weber's interpretation of Confucian societies as being inherently passive, he got that spectacularly wrong. I mean, look at the most developed countries on earth today. Among them are Northeast Asian countries with very strong Confucian background, South Korea, Japan, and of course, the biggest manufacturing power of all time, China. There's also Taiwan. There's also Chinese majority Singapore. There's also Vietnam, another Confucian country. No, all of these countries have been influenced by Chinese Confucian culture throughout thousands of years. And today, they were able to embrace capitalism in the most successful way while maintaining very equal, broadly equal societies, right? Within, I mean, yes, North and South Korea are different, but within South Korea, levels of inequality are very, very low compared to, say, United States or the Philippines and other capitalist countries. So in short, yes, there were confusion in terms of their traditions, but their interpretation of Confucianism and the mixture of Confucianism with modern culture evolved over time until they became innovative, until they embraced openness and democracy and human rights in Japan, in South Korea, in Taiwan. In China, they have not done that on the political front, but on the economic front, China is just amazing in terms of its economic strides. I mean, people were making joke of Huawei or Cherry cars back in the days. Just 10 years ago, I remember when I was, you know, in college, Chinese car, what a joke, right? But now look at electric cars made by China. My God, they're even better than Tesla. I mean, they look nicer than Tesla. Look at some of them. I mean, I want, in few years time, probably I'll even buy a Chinese electric car than an American electric car, especially if they're going to be way cheaper as they are, no? Chinese phones are not too bad, right? A lot of us are using Chinese phones, right? Huawei, Xiaomi, among others. It's incredible. Look at Alibaba of China. So Weber got that spectacularly wrong. So 100 years ago, he looked at China and said, oh, Confucian people, backward, passive and all. And today, Chinese mixed that Confucianism with capitalism, with communism and all of that. And a new alchemy of cultural innovation came out, right? So what is the lesson? To say that ang Pilipino ay ganito dahil ganito yung kultura natin just completely misses the point. Let's not forget, the Asian Development Bank was established in Manila, right? In the mid-1960s, not 70s, but 60s, right? That matters. Why? Because the Philippines was one of the fastest growing economies in the 1950s and early 1960s. In fact, the choice for the Asian Development Bank was between Philippines, Tehran, and Seoul, so Manila. And eventually, Philippines was chosen, not knowing that things will change in the Philippines within the next 10 to 20 years and so on and so forth, right? So same, we are Filipino rin tayo in the 1950s and 60s, yet, you know, we were among the fastest growing economies. So you cannot explain economic development and political success based on just culture alone, because countries that used to be successful 50 years ago are not so now. Countries that were poor 50 years ago are very successful now. So there must be a different explanation, right? Not to mention, I mean, kung pumunta kayo sa ibang bansa, sinasabi niya, ang Pilipino ay pasaway ganito. I'm sorry, I've been in three continents in the past year. So kahit may pandemic, nag-travel pa rin ako. That was really hard. So that meant 1 month in quarantine and all of that. But, you know, ang hindi po pasaway ang Pilipino kung kinumpara mo sa mga ibang bansa. I mean, have you been to US? I mean, during pandemic, Americans don't want to even put mask. Not even mask. Eh, tayo nga, nagsishield pa nga tayo. Nakita ko yung mga tao walking alone in EDSA, nakashield and mask pa nga yung iba. I mean, that's unthinkable in a lot of countries. Hindi tayo pasaway, no? And if you've been in other countries, you look at the Filipinos, they're very successful. They race to managerial positions. They follow rules. They're law-abiding citizens. Filipinos follow rules when they see their leaders follow the rules. Filipinos follow rules when they see the system is based on rule of law, right? But when we see our rulers are corrupt, the system is not working, parang ikaw pa nga yung mali, di ba? If you, it's like, ikaw lang nagpo-follow sa traffic light, no one else follows. Guess, sino ma-aksidente? Yung nagpo-follow ng traffic light. Because you have to go with the flow, right? Not with the traffic light, if no one is following the traffic light. So this is the problem we're having in the Philippines. So culture can change depending on institutional arrangements, depending on how culture evolves, depending on leaders who come. And I mean, you can even introduce new cultures to an organization. We have seen basketball teams or schools or university used to be so good and then they became ewan or baliktad. They used to be sloppy, good leaders came in, good institutions were established, and they became good basketball team or so on and so. So you can reform. So culture can change. And no country is stuck with a certain culture. Even Japan, which we look at, you know, today if we look at Japan, oh, a unified country, you know, very in technological development and all. I mean, look at history of Japan. I mean, if you don't want to read books, watch Samurai X, right? Kenshin Himura, right? It is the story of Japan breaking away from its traditional feudal background. You know, in the past 150 years ago, a lot of Japanese were farmers, peasants, working hours were short, 6 to 8 hours probably. Japan was largely a poor, feudal, backward country. But there was a revolution between the more forward-looking samurais and versus the Tokugawa, who are the backward-looking traditionalist samurais. And eventually, Kenshin Himura and the Samurai X, who sided with the forward-looking Meiji samurais, right, and leaders, they won. And they modernized Japan within a matter of 50 years. So from 1870 to 1920, Japan went from a backward agricultural country into one of the most powerful industrial powers on earth, right? And by 1940s, Japan was already competing with the biggest powers, including the United States, right? So within generations, countries can radically change if there are radical reforms with good leadership. Again, we see that in history. So this is why I have very big problems with this, some of these works, like James Fallow's essay, which you know, it's on the curriculum of many people, like, the culture in question fits Philippines. So, and parang sinasabi niya, ang Filipino, we're very dependent, we're very this and that. Na, yeah, but I mean, this guy forgets that the Philippines was also among the most developed, you know, four generations ago or three generations ago. In fact, panahon ni Rizal, Philippines had the highest literacy rate in Southeast Asia, right? Yes, most Filipinos didn't have literacy, but have you, if you were in Indonesia or Malaysia, or, there was barely Singapore even back then, you know, literacy rates were way lower than the Philippines. We had Ilustrados. We had University of Santo Tomas. We had Ateneo. You know, we had one of the best educational institutions in Asia back in the day, right? So what happened, right? So, you know, so at some point, the Philippines was ahead of everyone else in the region. In fact, twice, during the time of Rizal and then by the mid-20th century, right? So again, that's why you cannot reduce it to culture, because we have been Filipinos. Or you cannot say that culture is static. Maybe culture changes, right? And that's something that you have to keep in mind. Those are the questions that you have to keep in mind. So in short, these are the problems. The cultural arguments are orientalist reductionism. Parang, ang Pilipino ay ganito lang. That's nonsense. Because Filipinos, we can change, we can improve, or we can get worse. I mean, just like any other human beings, right? It's empirically questionable, as I mentioned, in the case of Jews, Confucian societies, Catholic societies, a lot of them became very rich and powerful over time. It also rejects common sense. As I mentioned, like for instance, South Korea and North Korea, almost exactly the same cultural, historical background, and yet a completely different outcome. China and Taiwan, for instance, one becomes a prosperous democratic country, while China's, yes, economically successful, but still a developing country and a very authoritarian system. Both Chinese, very different outcome. Singapore also, Chinese majority, but different from both Taiwan and China. So they're all Chinese, but very different outcomes, politically and economically. You cannot explain it through culture alone. That's just nonsense, right? So this is a problem. And by the way, what do you really mean by culture? It's a very vague idea, concept, right? So generally, be very, very skeptical of this monocausal explanation. Yung isang factor lang explains everything, because it's always more complicated than that. Now, I'm going to go quickly through this. If you look at the history of successful countries in Asia, how did South Korea go from one of the poorest countries in 1950s to one of the richest today? The same with Japan. How did it go from a backward country in 1860s? By 1920, it was one of the most developed. It beat Russia. It was a major force by Second World War. How did Malaysia, Thailand, Vietnam, Indonesia to a certain degree succeed? You know, there are many interesting books on that that focus on policy, good policy developed by not only political leaders, but bureaucrats and technocrats in charge of Department of Trade and Industry, key departments who oversee national development over not 6 years term, but over a generation or so. So generally, this is what, according to, this is a very good book. I really suggest. I mean, it's not that expensive. I think the Kindle is just like $6 or something. So please buy it. I mean, it's a really good book. It opens your mind. It has parang 60 pages of references lang. It's a solid book. Written by economist who has a PhD in Cambridge, written by a journalist who has a PhD in economics. So he explains very complicated issue in a way that is very easy to understand. Fantastic book. I really suggest it. And then there are more policy-oriented books that I really suggest. This is one of my favorites, Danny Roderick's book, among others, whereby he says that these are the three formulas that make certain countries successful in Asia and certain not. One of them is that countries that had successful land reform programs, meaning they distributed lands owned by oligarchs and among others to smaller landowners, that helped a lot. It created the market in the rural area. It lifted a lot of peasant families from extreme poverty. It actually raised even the yield in a lot of lands, and it helped a lot of children of farmers to be educated, sent to universities, and to work up the ladder of of personal success. The other thing is they all work on export-oriented industrialization. So when Park Chung-hee, the dictator, kapanahon ni Marcos yan, ng Korea, when he was in charge, he had cronies. He had cronies, just like Marcos, but he gave money to his cronies from the tax money. So ordinary South Korean suffered. But he made clear, if I'm going to give you this money, you make a product that can be exported to America in the next 5 to 10 years. If you do not meet that target, I'll take away all your money. And with that strict conditionality, guess what? LG, Samsung, all of these guys, they used to be owned by oligarchs who are like, they had their own, you know, puro mga landed elite mga yan, mga walang kwenta sa manufacturing. But under pressure by Park Chung-hee, right? These companies became conglomerates, manufacturing conglomerates. Like South Korea had no manufacturing background in the 50s in any discernible way. They had no shipbuilding background. So what they did was to send engineers and experts to Japan, to Germany, to Scotland. And within two to three decades, large parts of that under Park Chung-hee, right? They were forced to become competitive in manufacturing industries based on very clear standards. In contrast, other dictators, including some people we know, had cronies, and the cronies kept on getting money. Kahit walang kwenta yung ginagawa nila, kahit corrupt sila, walang competence, kahit wala sila napuproduce. So by the end of Park Chung-hee era, China, South Korea was moving towards creating Hyundai, LG, all of these products we know. We also had an experience of someone like Park Chung-hee, but by the end of his term, did we produce a national car? Where are Samsung? Where are Hyundai? So that's the question that we have to really ask ourselves. Because other countries had authoritarian leaders that actually implemented very good policies. It's about policies and also financial regulation, right? Now, I remember this very well. I mean, I did Taekwondo. I got my black belt in Taekwondo. So I dealt with Koreans a lot, who were among people who trained me. I'm from Baguio. So back in the days, and daming Koreans in Baguio. So whenever you talk to Koreans, they say, oh, we develop because we love our country. We buy our products. Well, back in the days, Korean products were crap, right? Like Kia cars were a joke in 1980s and 1990s. They were really ugly cars, right? Like the front is Toyota, back is like, oh, the side is Volvo. It was a joke. But ordinary Koreans had no choice because to buy foreign cars was so expensive. So what the government in Korea did was to impose very high tariffs on imported products, but force these companies to share their technology domestically. And then eventually they also were able to build their own cars, which did not get a lot of taxes. So napaka cheap yung mga local cars nila compared to foreign cars. So even if you are not a nationalistic Korean, unless you were very rich, you couldn't buy really foreign products. So they forced their people to buy Korean cars when they were crappy, until those crappy cars became very good, because their governments made sure that the people in charge of making those cars will meet certain standards. Otherwise, they'll be called out, right? So that is what happened. That is the success story that we see in many countries, Korea being the number one, but also we see versions of that in Southeast Asia, in Taiwan, and of course, back in the days, also in Japan. So if Koreans have the chaebols, right, the conglomerates, no, my oligarchs din sila, but their oligarchs are very efficient, right? They produce jobs and everything. I mean, 1/4 of Korean economy is controlled by chaebols. So they are really oligarchs in that sense. But they produce for their country. They help their country, right? You may know there's scandal with Samsung, the head of Samsung, na corruption scandal, but he's now going to come out of jail. You see, even if they're corrupt, they do something for their country. They create jobs. They create good companies. That's what they do in Korea, right? Even their corrupt people help their country, right? That's the problem we have in other countries. That corrupt lang, walang ginawa, dinala lang yung pera sa Switzerland, wala nangyari sa bansa, no? In Korea, they corrupt, but the money stays in the country, produces cars, produces jobs. That's the difference, right? So policies matter. Now, whether these policies are implemented by a dictator or a democratic government, which came into Taiwan and Korea by the 1980s and 90s, well, the issue is to get the right policies in place. And that's how trajectories of countries can dramatically change over time. So yes, it's true. It's good to have great man of history with political leader and everything like that. But the reality is that, you know, while there have been some really strong authoritarian leaders who brought success to their countries, I cannot deny that. That's a fact. But for every successful, you know, for every successful authoritarian country you see, there are also many unsuccessful countries which had authoritarian leaders and things got even worse, right? So we'll just look at some of the data here, for instance, of the country. So it is true, for instance, authoritarian countries like China, like Egypt, like Tunisia in the past, they did very well in terms of human development index, like kudos to them, right? But if you look at also the least successful countries, like Niger, Burundi, Mali, you know, these also are authoritarian countries. So to say that porque naging authoritarian ka, magiging successful ka, you miss the point. And in fact, numerically, this is the problem. You can have a good, strong dictatorial leader in a sense that he brings economic development. But over time, that leader can get corrupted. Over time, that leader can get sick. Over time, that leader can change his mind. And over time, that leader may not want to give up power. And then there's conflict over succession and all. This is what Francis Fukuyama calls the bad emperor problem. No? So it's true. We have had authoritarian leaders like Lee Kuan Yew, like Deng Xiaoping, like in the past. But for every one or two successful authoritarian leader you can name me, I can name you dozens of very not successful authoritarian leaders like Gaddafi, like Mugabe, like Mobutu. I mean, this is the Transparency International's list of the most corrupt leaders on earth, right? Who devastated their country's economies, right? And in some of these countries, I mean, just look at the list. I'm not going to read the list, but you can see most of them are they're practically all dictatorships, right? And look at billions of dollars have stolen. And in some countries, you know, you're gonna still pay their debt. We're still gonna pay the debt of those guys. This is the problem, right? But anyways, I'm not gonna go deep into this because we don't want this to get, you see, this is not about politics, this is about development, right? So we're looking at data, right? So dictators can bring success for a short period, and then it can go all negative, 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 negative like that, right? That's the problem because there's no checks and balances. So this is a very interesting graph I'll show you, right? So look at the most improved countries. So you have India, you have Nepal, more democracy, Bangladesh, but you also have China and Benin, more authoritarians. Okay, sure. But look at the countries who are the most inconsistent, you know, up and down, up and down, up and down, you know? Zambia, Liberia, Congo, Zimbabwe. Like a lot of these countries have been under dictatorial rulers who happen to be also very corrupt and all. So at first they start well. You can see very nice starts. So like, wow, galing, may dictator tayo, inayos lahat. Pero over time, boom, go down. And once those leaders go down, the whole thing just completely collapses. So this is case of Zimbabwe, right? So if you're familiar with the history of Zimbabwe, Mugabe was a great leader at the beginning. He was seen as a freedom fighter. He kicked out the white racists who were in charge of Zimbabwe, Rhodesia back in the days. So things started very well in his country. Huh? Impressive. Here, you see how impressive it was. 1980, 1985, 1990, and then it goes down like that. So this is the problem with having dictatorial leaders. Some of them, like China, can succeed. But I would argue that China is not just a dictatorial. It's a party-led regime, right? So because it's collective leadership, with the exception of Mao and potentially under Xi Jinping, when they're under collective leadership, like the time of Deng Xiaoping, like the time of Jiang Zemin and Hu Jintao, they were able to correct each other kung may mistake. So walang isang sabog na leader bring everything down. So they slowly moved it up. No, but you know, India also did very well. It's a democracy that moved in the right direction. Bangladesh also did very well, right? So we might want to look at China. So this is China, right? And be impressed. But you look at Nepal, look at Bangladesh, look at India. You know, these were democracies who did also pretty well in terms of human development index, in terms of education levels, infant mortality, so on and so forth. So we're not giving enough credit also to democracy that didn't do too bad. And also we tend to forget that not all autocracies are going to be like China. A lot of them are going to end up like Zimbabwe. This is the problem we have. So we see that also in the case of the Philippines, how inconsistent the growth was. So fantastic growth in 1972, 9%, 5%, 5%, 7%. And then you can say by 1984, it's pure negative now. And then that growth was also not sustainable because there was a lot of current account deficit and deficit. You see deficit, deficit, deficit. And that means utang ng utang ng utang, no? And that's why our currency goes down and we have to pay the debt from back in the days. Again, I don't want to make this about politics, but I have to show you this because you have to see the relevance of what I'm telling you here, right? And, you know, if you don't believe me, ask Lee Kuan Yew of Singapore what he had to say about our former strongman leader. But let's go beyond that. Let's go beyond that because our discussion now is about 21st century and how should we succeed in 21st century. If there's one book I'm going to suggest on that, really good book, because I really helped to open up my mind, was this book called The End of Power by Moses Naim, who was a former finance minister in Venezuela and former editor at large of Foreign Policy magazine. He argued that physics of power has transformed, making it easier to get, harder to use, and easier to lose. Because we live in a more crowded world, a more complicated world, a world of many people moving around. So the old style of mayor style of trying to rule the country doesn't work. You have to have an idea of big picture. You have to have big data. You have to be active and proactive, right? You have to understand data, how to use data analytics in terms of policy making. So the old way is not going to work anymore because the world works in a very, very different ways, no? And in fact, if you look at some of the studies like Zaworski et al. And Rushir Sharma, they look at over time, actually, on average, regime typology actually not a big indicator. For some of them, what matters more is policy than whether you're democracy or authoritarianism. And I would argue that if authoritarianism over time doesn't provide more benefits than democracy in terms of economic development, then actually it's also bad in a sense that it also deprives you of human rights and basic freedoms and social liberties. I'll just be very honest with you. If this were not a democracy, well, we're not a perfect democracy, a bigger problem. Probably I wouldn't even give this lecture to you guys. Probably I would be giving this lecture from abroad, no? From exile. So freedom matters because freedom allows us to have these discussions. Even if you disagree with me, right? At least we can have this discussion. If we were an authoritarian system like China, I wouldn't dare to give this lecture about my country, right? Because I would be scared, right? Although, of course, maybe I will not be scared, but a lot of other academics would be scared. Or you could lose your job. You could lose everything, right? So this is the problem we have. And if you look at this great book, Why Nations Fail, it essentially looks at the role of institutions. Institutions very, very, very matter, no? So again, these are like some of the data shows, you know, which are the successful countries. So you can see here that the Philippines is in the lag behind countries. See green? And by the way, you see, our numbers is from 1950s onwards. So you can see, hindi tayo consistente. Maangat tayo, tas pumababa tayo. So, hindi, unfortunately, yun ang nangyari sa atin. So you compare us, for instance, to other countries like Singapore, Taiwan, South Korea, Hong Kong, they consistently went up. But, you know, there are other also countries, you know, like India, for instance, slightly better than us, fast-growing countries. So we are not as bad as trapped countries, but we have been lagging behind and we have not sustained this. And so clearly there is a problem, both with our economic policies, both with our political institutions. And as far as institutions are concerned, I don't know if did I put it in here. How do you define institutions? Institutions are human designed organizations, bodies, departments that are meant to solve specific problems. A more academic explanation is that institutions are regularized behavior that gain value over time. So for instance, tax collection. At one point, tax collection made sense for a king, and then he realized that you have to keep on doing tax collection if you want to keep the kingdom. So he created a BIR, right? So BIR is an institution, right? But in general, state is an institution. So the state covers all sorts of organizations and agencies in charge of creating order in society and bringing stability and prosperity. So if your institutions are extractive, meaning andyan lang yung institution mo para mag-corrupt ng mga bad leaders or foreign powers, then that's gonna not help the country. But if your institutions are inclusive, meaning it creates order and prosperity for the greatest number of people, then you have inclusive institutions. The same thing can apply also in the economic part. Do you have a capitalist system that creates jobs for majority of Filipinos, or do you have a capitalist system that makes few conglomerates and oligarchs rich, while majority of Filipinos' lives does not improve? So both your economic and political institutions have to be inclusive for it to work. Now, I'll just go quickly through this. I know based kayo sa Cebu, so you may not be a fan of Imperial Manila. And I think you'd rather talk English. Ako, I'm from Baguio. Mga Baguio, mayabang din kami. Parang kayo mga Cebuano or mga Davaoenio, you know, we think we are our own thing, you know. And hindi kami impressed easily with people in Manila. So I can see the pride, no? And in fact, even in Baguio, we rather talk English than, or Ilocano for that matter, than Tagalog. But I understand that a lot of people are saying maybe pag naging federalismo ang Pilipinas, all our problems will be okay, or naging parliamentary tayo, everything will be okay. Now, just to give you an idea about why that argument is very simplistic, is that I'll give you three countries with very similar political systems. So if you are saying that changing your political system, for instance, if naging parliamentary tayo, bigla tayo maging United Kingdom or bigla tayo maging Sweden or whatever. So you have three countries with very similar political system with dominant presidents and a parliament. All are members of OECD, so they're all relatively developed countries. So France, South Korea, and Turkey. So you would imagine that if they adopt similar political system, over time, they'll have more or less similar outcomes, right? In terms of economic development and politics. No? Kasi kung, yun nga, if political system is a cause for success, then if you have similar political system, you have to have similar outcomes, which is maging similar successful tayo. So if you look at France, Turkey, and South Korea, all of these countries, similar political systems, but over time, they're actually diverging. They're not converging. Turkey is becoming a more and more authoritarian system, right? And if you look at its numbers, over time, longitudinal in terms of democracy index, economic competitive press freedom, it keeps on going lower actually in certain areas. Economic competitiveness is not bad in terms of Turkey, but their inflation is very high, but press freedom and democracy actually deteriorated. South Korea, interestingly, is getting ahead of France. So France used to be the model of democracy and all, but France is increasingly becoming less economically competitive and democratically open than South Korea, which is a newer democracy and newer capitalist system. So three countries, similar political system, but very divergent outcomes. South Korea is increasingly becoming the better of all of them. Turkey is increasingly becoming more authoritarian with its economy slowing down, while France is just not as impressive as it used to be. So to say that just because we'll make our political system something like them and then we'll be like them doesn't make sense, because you have three countries, similar systems, but very different outcomes over time. So that is where explanations cannot be just brought down to that. No, I'll just go through this because we have no time for that. This is a very long lecture, so maybe a different day I can give you a lecture. But this is my argument. Were we to decentralize the Philippines, what the hell do you think is going to happen? By the way, we already have a local government code, and then we also have a new ruling by the Supreme Court, which is supposed to compel national government to give more resources to local government units. So there's already, don't reinvent the wheel, there's already legislations that should give more power and resources to local government. But nonetheless, some want to go federalism. The problem is that once you go federalism and you have a very unequal society, guess what's going to happen, right? What's going to happen is that more developed places like Cebu, like Metro Manila, probably Davao, right, or Baguio, they'll do well, right? Because under federalism, each to his own, right? We keep our resources to our own. So if you're already richer, you keep your rich resources to your own, you also attract more investments and richer and more educated people. And if you're less developed and you're on your own, bahala ka sa buhay mo, you don't have much tax collection capability, magkaka problema ka rin. Because if you look at tax collection, most of the taxes in the Philippines, a large part of that, I'm sorry to say, comes from industrialized places, especially the NCR region. So a part of our taxes actually goes to other regions. We have to subsidize other regions under our system, right? As the more developed part, we have to subsidize it. But under a federal system, it's very possible. And look at the United States. United States is a federalized system over more than a century, two centuries for that matter. And look at US. So you go to New York or California, extremely developed, right? New York, California, wow. Hollywood, Times Square. But you go to Kansas, you go to Tennessee, you go to Louisiana, you go to other parts of the US. Very, very different. Very, very different. Far poorer, far more conservative, far more white, not diverse. So US federal system, rich country, but very different outcomes. Very different outcomes in the sense that over time, hindi nag-narrow yung gaps. If anything, Sunshine States or California East Coast, East Coast in New York, sorry, and then West Coast in California, they're actually getting richer and richer, and they're becoming more, and U.S. is becoming more and more unequal, right? So I'm not saying it doesn't matter what is your political system or rather form of government, really. What I'm saying is that it's not the magic bullet. What is more important is your broader institutions and whether they're inclusive or not, right? That is what matters. And yes, you want to talk about federalism? Well, Mexico, Nigeria, Brazil, Venezuela, India, Iraq, they have various versions of decentralization, which is either officially federalism or a version of federalism. But, you know, people who push for federalism, they don't talk about these countries. They talk about, I don't know, Germany or whatever, as if you copy their system immediately, you'll be like them. But look at other developing poor countries that also have semi-federal or federalized system, and they didn't turn out very well. In fact, once they became federalized, they became even more divided and unequal. So these are the problems that I see with some of this analysis, but that's a separate discussion, right? And not to mention mahal po gumastos. I mean, to shift the federal system, that means a lot of changes in our government. There are a lot of reports that suggest that, by the way, kung ikaw ay nag-work sa local government unit, once we become fully federalized, yung sahod mo po mo ay pwede bumaba. Became more provincial level sahod compared to the national government level that we're paid in the past, you know? And these are like, even the shift to federalism could cost our government $253 billion. Anyways, I think I'm overwhelming you with all of that. What I'm trying here is not to convince you about a specific argument. What I'm trying to do here is for you not to buy nonsense arguments, for you not to easily buy whatever arguments out there being thrown by bloggers or politicos with ulterior motives. I remember I gave a lecture after the late Nene Pimentel. Of course, he was pro-federalism and all in the morning, and then after I gave a lecture. And then interestingly, some of the politicians responded to me and said, Prof, ano ba yung mga bago opisina ay bubukas pag naging federal tayo? Because as you may know, under federal systems, like in Germany, for instance, you can have a parliament also on the provincial level. So para may kongreso at senado ka, dun rin sa provincial level, similar to what we're going to have in Bangsamoro. So some politicians like to have federal because under federal system, mas kontrolado pa nila yung kanilang mga areas. Mas magiging king pa sila, no? At mas magkakaroon ng mga subsidiary government institutions na pwede i-corrupt at i-dominate na kanilang mga kamag-anak, mga anak, asawa, or sila mismo, no? So, you know, everything looks nice in theory and idea, but how is it going to be implemented on the ground? That's the big issue. And that's where I see very, very, very weak argument by some of the people pushing for some of these changes, no? So this is what I'm going to tell you. You want to have a successful leadership, you have to have these elements. You have to have a state which is capable. It can provide you basic public services. It can enforce law and order. It has to be autonomous. Hindi siya apektado ng mga oligarchs, mga lobbying groups, mga foreign powers. No, hindi siya probinsya ng ibang bansa. It has to be impersonal, meaning it has to focus on long-term national development, not just goal of a president or two, not just the objectives of a certain business or politicians. And it has to be meritocratic. Napakamahalaga po yung civil service examinations. Napakamahalaga po na yung mga tao nagiging assistant secretary ay hindi yung mga bloggers na pro someone here and there, pero actually yung mga tao na may alam dun sa mga departments na pinapasok nila. No, again, we're not gonna name names, but there are some people who ended up in very senior positions in recent years. And I don't know what the hell is their qualification to be there. Napaka-demoralizing po yan. Kung ikaw ay isang civil servant, nag-examination ka, nag-aral ka, andun ka, and then bigla ang boss mo ay isang tao na walang alam sa buhay or walang alam at least sa political and governance, andyan lang siya dahil malapit siya kay presidente or tumulong siya sa election time. That's deplorable. And that's why we have incompetence. Because people are put in positions of power. A lot of them are political appointees. That's why one of my suggestions is that bawasan po yung political appointees. Dapat po yung mga top positions sa ating gobyerno ay based sa meritocracy, based sa examinations, based on promotions, based on merit, at sila po ay na cleared by commission and appointments, and meron tayong process whereby meron tayong kumbaga may standards, no? May standards sana tayo, no? So even if you have good cabinet members or president, kung yung mga assistant secretaries mo, kung yung mga undersecretaries mo, kung yung mga a little bit lower mid-level officials ay mga kung sino-sino lang na nandyan dahil kilala nila si ganito, ay magkakaproblema talaga po tayo. Because leadership matters not only on the level of president but also the mid-level and lower levels. No? So these are the things that are very important. So I'll keep it here and I'll leave you with some ideas. You know, so one of the discussions we're having today is that, is this the future? Meaning, are the future leaders, are the young, charismatic, proactive? Again, I'm not endorsing anyone. I'm talking about typology of a leader. So if you notice all of these persons there in the picture, they are very similar, right? All of them have populist charisma. So mahalaga na may charisma ka, hindi pwedeng wala kang charisma, technocrat ka lang. But do you back up that charisma also with competence, with merit? with studying, with familiarity with public administration, with bothering to go on the ground and helping people who are in need of help, right? So is this the future? Is this the kind of leader we need in the 21st century? So I'm not going to be ageist, but I think whoever is dynamic enough, who appreciates big data, who can delegate tasks, because not one person can lead everything. Dapat competent in cabinet members mo, dapat competent in assistant secretaries mo, dapat make sure na yung mga scalawags ay inaalis sa mga gobyerno, good people get in, good people get promoted. All of those elements come together, because otherwise, you're going to see what happened in Afghanistan. Of course, we're not Afghanistan in many ways, but you see the metaphor, right? What happened in Afghanistan is a kind of a cautionary tale that you can put some nice guys on the very, very top, but if you mid-level mo in all of that, I bulok, no? At yung mga incompetent people are not being promoted, you will end up with this. These kinds of people are going to rule your country, right? Not Taliban per se, but people who are not supposed to be there, right? Because they're not people who are 21st century leadership material. Let's just put it that way. So unfortunately, Afghanistan went from 21st century to 12th century, right, in a matter of days, because they didn't have a robust, strong, autonomous state that could produce good leaders on multiple levels and could actually overcome, even if they had incompetent leaders at the very top. So with that, I'll end my point, because I want to open it for more discussions. Dahil alam ko, baka na-overwhelm kayo, but remember, you're not supposed to learn everything I said to you. You're supposed to get the sensibility. Dapat ang nakukuha mo dito sa ating discussion is, o nga no, yung parang ganun, or parang na-confuse ako lalo. But that's a good thing. Sometimes to be more confused means that you're questioning your preconceived notions. Because marami sa atin, napaka-sigurado tayo sa isang idea. Yung pala, walang kwenta yung ideas natin. But we stick to them because we're not willing to interrogate them. So what I'm trying to do here is to give you new ways of thinking and new ideas about what will work. And obviously what I showed you today is what will not work. No? Maybe we can have a separate discussion of what will work, but I cannot go deep into that because parang mukhang I don't end up endorsing anyone because I don't want to do that. But I'm clearly not endorsing certain values and styles of leadership. And at the end of the day, institutions matter. It's important na yung mga departments natin are based on merit, na yung mga tao na walang alam, they should not end up as assistant secretary or undersecretaries, that people who become our presidents, who become our cabinet ministers, who become senator of the republic, they should know what they're talking about, and they should have an appreciation of the limitation of power of just one man and actually work with a team. And each team will work with its own teams, and so on and so forth, right? So network leadership, delegated leadership, big data, evidence-based leadership, yan po ang kailangan natin in the 21st century. And that's why, and that's how the Philippines can succeed po. So I'll just keep it there and looking forward to your questions and answers. Maraming salamat po and pasensya na po kung medyo nag-overextend tayo.
Thank you so much, Dr. Hidarian. That was indeed an insightful and fruitful talk. And I also agree with you that it takes a multi-level competent and good leaders to build strong institutions, right, Sir Ian?
Yes, definitely. I agree with you, Ms. Cha. I hope that we are able to reflect regarding our perspectives, especially when it comes to leadership. Actually, I personally realized from the talk this afternoon that clear policies and strong institutions really matter. And perhaps we could actually try to think that we should not depend on a single leader, but we should also think of leadership not just from the president only, but also from the other positions. Maybe it be elected or appointed. So at this point, let us proceed with the open forum. Again, for those participants who are in Zoom, you may type your questions in the chat box. And for those who are watching via Facebook Live, you may also type your questions in the comment section. So we actually received initial questions already. So here's the first question, Professor Hidarian. So the first question here is, this is actually from a student. So here, my question is, does the current system of certain countries, for example, Afghanistan, or even in our country, have to do with poor leadership? Then if yes, do you suggest to have a system change? So, thank you, Pop.
Are there other questions to go? We can take a couple of questions and then go through them.
Otherwise, I can go with that. Yeah, I mean, just in case
yes, you want to cover more. Merong similar question. This is also from an...
Similar, let's pack them together.
Okay. No, then the other one also is from Thailand. Similar situation. Our another participant is actually from Thailand. So here, it was mentioned that since I've been working here for more than 8 years, then during my first day of stay here and until now, rallies, riots, and bloody protests are visible in the streets of Bangkok. Then recently, the Thai protesters clashed with riot police over handling of COVID situation, demanding the resignation of the prime minister. So in addition, activists in Bangkok forced back with tear gas and rubber bullets. With that being said, does it mean that the governance or leadership here in Thailand is weak in nature? Please give me your personal point of view, sir. Thank you.
Yeah, okay, thank you very much for that. I mean, there's a reason why I didn't mention Thailand among the more successful ones in the region, even though actually Thailand has been among the more successful ones in terms of industrialization and manufacturing. So if you look at Thailand, it's actually one of the biggest producers of cars. Marami sa ating mga Toyotas nat and Hondas nat, and they may be actually, especially Toyotas, no? They're actually made in Thailand, no? Not in Japan, no? So actually Thailand has been a manufacturing hub. It's called Detroit of Asia for a very long time. For people who have been to Bangkok or have gone to Bangkok over the years, no, Bangkok has developed so much. I'm so impressed with the infrastructure there, you know, compared to the 1990s. So you can see in 15 to 20 years, you know, Bangkok used to look more like Manila, no? Horrible traffic, rivers were dirty and everything like that. And now, I mean, you can go to beautiful restaurants on Bangkok rivers. You have multi-level highways, no? That really cuts traffic. So I'm really impressed by Thailand. I'm really impressed by how much growth Thailand has had. And I think a lot of success of Thailand goes back to the 1980s when a bunch of technocrats, Japanese style, in the departments of industry and trade. Remember, I mentioned yung mahalaga yung meron kang mga bureaucrats who sustain good policies over time, yung economic policy, trade policy. So Thailand was able to do that. My mentor, Walden Bellew, has written a lot on Thailand and the success of Thailand. So I really suggest you to check some of his works. I've written a little bit on comparisons of Thailand and the Philippines. But this is the problem. Thailand got a lot of things right, including population management, trade and industry. That's why Thailand now is twice richer than Philippines. So per capita income of Thailand, I think, is around $6,000 to $7,000, which is closer to Turkey, Iran, and Brazil. While Philippines is barely $3,000. So we used to be almost the same level as Thailand. So up until 1980, I think same ang Philippines and Thailand. And the last 30 years, ang laki ng difference ng two countries. So if your base is the Philippines, Thailand has done very well. But there was big problems with Thailand. One big problem is that much of the growth, sorry, I'm going to go back to the other question. Don't worry. But I think the Thailand one is an interesting one because it's not the successful case, but it's like a mixed case, which gives us a lot of lessons. So, I mean, we can talk about Afghanistan, but I think Thailand is also interesting because it's close to us, no? So Thailand, one problem is that a lot of growth is concentrated in Bangkok area, right? And then Phuket and all of that. So it's a very highly concentrated growth. I mean, in the Philippines, I can say, okay, you have Chiang Mai and all, but I would say that the level of concentration is even worse than the Philippines in many ways, no? North of Thailand, the level of development is far lower than the Bangkok regions and all. So, I mean, Chiang Mai is so away from Bangkok, right? The difference is so huge. So in short, the distribution has been a big problem in Thailand. And then, of course, you have other elements coming in. And that, of course, that geographic economic inequality contributed to the rise of people like Thaksin Shinawat. Now, if you know the background of Thaksin Shinawat, he's kind of like a combination of Duterte and Bato, no? And like Duterte, Bato, and Bongo all put together, right? So he's Chinese ethnically, right? He's a former police chief. He's a very good entrepreneur. And he was the original populist here in Southeast Asia, no? So in the 1990s up until early 2000s, Thaksin Shinawat transformed Thailand. And one reason he was very, very popular, Thaksin Shinawat, was because he invested in he focused on the neglected people in Thailand. So under Thaksin Shinawat, they introduced universal healthcare. I think meron silang parang $1 healthcare program, no? The roads, if you go to the rural areas of Thailand, is very, very nice, very well-paved roads. a lot of this development happened under Thaksin. But the problem with Thaksin was, as he tried to distribute the wealth and all, well, first, there were a lot of corruption scandals with him. He had his own telecommunications sector. So parang bad Robin Hood ang nangyari. No? So he's like, he's helping, but he's not an innocent Robin Hood. He's doing his own shenanigans, right? That was the other thing with Thaksin was, he was trying to compete also with other Chinese. I mean, the Chinese control more or less Thailand. A lot of them are really ethnic Chinese, including the monarchy, you know. So the Thaksin was also beginning to challenge the monarchy and the other Chinese elite in Thailand, right? Thankfully, Thailand, like Philippines, is very open. Hindi tayo masyadong racist, no? I mean, compared to what happened to the Chinese minority in Malaysia, Indonesia, horrible, horrible. So yes, meron tayong xenophobia, unfortunately, xenophobia. But Thailand is a very, very tolerant country, right? But anyways, there was also a big challenge to the monarchy and the yellows, yung dilawan ng Bangkok, no? Tapos, di ba, pula, red yung Thaksin, no? Poy Thai party, no? So in short, he had good intentions. He did good things, but he was the bad vessel. He was the bad Robin Hood. And in the process, I think Thaksin overdid it. No, he went over the board. He didn't play the patient game. He wanted to go all the way for it. He was very popular. And what happened? The military stepped in. And this is where Philippines is a better country than Thailand, I would say, in a sense that at least our military is not as interventionist as the Thai military. I mean, I've lost, how many coups has Thailand had over the past 80 years? How many constitutions? It's like 12 constitutions? I mean, like, sorry, I lost count. Like, so that's the problem in Thailand. You have a military that just acts on its own. They believe they're guardians of the people. So kind of like Myanmar. So the thing with Thailand is that it's very developed in terms of technology and manufacturing compared to other Southeast Asian countries. Only Singapore and Malaysia probably are better than Thailand on that level. But the politics, especially the military politics, the civil military, it's like Myanmar level. So that's why it's a very weird combination of these two. And so, as I said, Hawaii nations fail. No, for you to be sustained, developed, dapat you have both elements, inclusive political and economic institutions. So I believe Thailand moved well on the economic institutions, became more and more inclusive and all, especially when Thaksin was trying to spread the wealth to the rural area. But the politics is so messy, right? The politics is so messy. So the story of Thailand in the past 10, 15 years is essentially remnants of Thaksin, his sister, and then other proxies versus all other elites who don't want Thaksin in. And then the military just come in and say, get the hell out of it. Let's adult take care of the situation. No? And in the meantime, the youth of Thailand are suffering, right? Middle class of Thailand are suffering. And I feel for Thailand. But I'll tell you one thing. In some ways, I have more hope in Thailand sometimes than us, in just one sense, because you have a bigger middle class and your student activism is way better than the Philippines. I'm so impressed by those young, like 14-year-old kids I saw in Bangkok, right? Who are protesting against the junta. My God, the courage, right? We have that in Philippines, but it's not the same level. So I think because Thailand developed economically at a certain degree, it created a big enough middle class like South Korea and Thailand and Taiwan in the 80s that can push for democracy. But your big problem is your military. I mean, I just don't know how we're going to get around that. Thank God we don't have in the Philippines. Our military learned its lesson from the Marcos era. They supported the Marcos dictatorship. It didn't go very well, right? And I know this very well because I'm very good friends with our people in our military, defense, even with police, no? So medyo gets ko yung mindset nila. Thankfully, our military is not in interventions and that has created a lot of trouble. So I think this is where what happens is that it's like parang, you know, it's like Olympics, right? It's not enough to be talented. You also have to have strategy and discipline and financing and support, right? So you have to have both. If you just have one and don't work on two, eventually the whole thing will fall apart. The two should move together at the same time, right? Or more or less so. And this is the problem. So in the Philippines, I think the problem could be a little bit more opposite. Like our politics became more open and democratic since 1986, you would say until recently. But our economy was not inclusive. So in 2013, I'll just give you some shocking numbers. 40 richest families in the Philippines took home 76% of newly created growth. The number in Thailand was around 30%, which is bad, but it was half of the Philippines. That means Thailand has more than twice better distribution of wealth than the Philippines. And to consider that Thailand is already twice richer than the Philippines, that tells you that average conditions in Thailand are better than the Philippines economically. But politically, I would say Philippines is ahead of Thailand, right? I would even say Philippines is ahead of Malaysia, because Malaysia is also a very developed country in terms of economy and technology, although there's small population, a lot of oil, so on and so forth. But their politics is so messy, right? Even messier than us, right? I mean, it is very possible that the next prime minister of Malaysia, I mean, they have had two prime ministers in the past 2 years, right? It's possible the next prime minister of Malaysia will be the body of the prime minister who was kicked out 3 years ago, Najib's. It's crazy. I mean, Malaysian politics is so confusing. Believe me, like I've written in Malaysia, I've been in Malaysia. My ex-partner, she was Australian, part Malaysian. So I used to go to Malaysia a lot. I'm quite familiar with Malaysia. But even I sometimes lose track of it's the Game of Thrones in Malaysia. It's very messy. So I would say politically, the Philippines is better than Thailand and Malaysia, despite my, you know, my position on many things happening in the past few years, right? I don't need to repeat it here. But I would say I'm more optimistic about our politics in that sense. Where I'm worried about is lack of activism among youth, which I think Thailand has very well. And I was very happy to see in Thailand, they have a new party, this billionaire young guy, no, created this new young party, etc. So you have that. We don't have that. So I don't know. Like, it's really a mixed picture. So Southeast Asia, we're a mix of mess. I mean, just look at Singapore, the most developed and all, but there's no democracy. I mean, good luck. Go Singapore, write something against Singaporean government. Let's see what happens to you. Then tell me if Singapore is democracy, right? I'd rather be in the Philippines than in Singapore, right? Like, if you're a scholar in Singapore, you write about everywhere but except Singapore, right? I mean, that's essentially the deal. But I'll keep it there. Now, again, on the question of change of government, there is some evidence to suggest that parliamentary tends to do better than presidential. But it's a question of comparing apples and oranges. So, for instance, this is how it's done. It's like Spain parliamentary, Bolivia, for instance, presidential. See, Spain is rich and Bolivia is not. But isn't that a stupid comparison? Because it's comparing apples and oranges. Spain is a European Union country which used to be the seat of empire. To compare the seat of empire with the colony in Latin America, a landlocked country, and say, oh, so maybe Spain became richer because they had parliamentary. That's dumb. I'm sorry. That's a stupid argument. I keep on hearing. No? Better argument is compare two apples or two oranges, right? Let's say you have two very similar countries. One became parliamentary, one became, and then let's compare. Let's see, right? So again, as I said, there are many developing countries who had parliamentary. Those are the countries we have to look at, because kung titignan lang natin yung mga successful, it's like, I don't know. It's like, you know, the metaphor I give is here. Maybe you're too young, but there was a player in NBA. His name was Sean Marion. I remember he used to shoot like this. Hindi siya ganyan, no? He used to shoot from the back, which was like weird, but it's so hard to block him, no? So you cannot block him. He can do 3 points like that. Now, to say that let's copy like the British Parliament and then we'll be like Britain is to say, if I shoot like Sean Marion, I'll be Sean Marion. But obviously, it took Sean Marion probably 15 years of practicing like that, until he became so good he could do it like that. So if you start like that, you're not going to be Sean Marion. Most likely matapalan ka or banking yung shoot mo, di ba? Unless, I don't know, you're a genius, which is... But, so, my point is like, napaka shallow na tingnan mo. Ay, kopyan lang natin yung parliament. Isn't that exactly what we did? We copied American presidential system of 19th century, thinking we'll be America. But knowing it's a very different cultural setup and all. So for me, we have to come up with a system that really adjusts and works with our culture and all. By the way, as I said, our culture can also change. So it's a very dynamic process, right? So going back to the parliamentary, in theory, I would say, yes, I preferably like parliament more. Parang prime minister, parang mas social. Parang president, parang dictator. You know? I like it. I would advocate for a parliamentary system in the Philippines. No? But let's not forget, to have an effective parliament system, you have to have real political parties. So make sure you have real political parties. Because kung wala kang real political parties, what's the point of prime minister system? The whole prime minister system is about strong parties competing based on policy platform, right? And a degree of personality. If you don't have that, you're going to be messy. And just look at UK. What a mess US, UK is. The Brexit and everything like that. I mean, they had 400 years of parliamentary democracy, and look at it, they're still crazy in many ways, right? So, like, so in short, I'm not saying parliament is bad. I'm just saying if someone said it's a magic solution, parang hindi niya na figure out. It's like you watch a video of Elon Musk, parang 10 minutes video of Elon, like going Elon Musk maging billionaire din ako. Like, that's not how it works, right? Like, there's so much backstory and luck and circumstances that came together. So sure, it's a very different. But federalism, I'm quite skeptical of that. Not because I don't want more power. You can do actually devolution and decentralization under existing system. My problem is this. Napakahina na nga yung national government mo. Eh. Napakahina. I mean, our government doesn't have control over a lot of islands. Kaya nga may insurgencies ka, di ba? Kaya yung NPA, gano'n. Tapos, uwi-weekend pa yung national government mo lalo. Eh, good luck na lang dyan, di ba? Tapos, ang dami mong mga trapos and mga warlords. I guess mo sino will be in charge pag nag-federalize tayo. They'll be completely in charge of their provinces. They will be completely in charge of those provinces. You think mga simple mga mayan will take over when it's federal? Good luck with that. Let's be realistic about it. So ang ganda no idea, but once you implement it, what are the realities on the ground? And the law of unintended consequences. Whenever you introduce a major change, there could be consequences that you didn't foresee. Case in point, Biden. Akala niya, withdraw lang siya, okay, nahad. He didn't foresee the whole thing just collapsed like that, right? Change is risky. So if you're going to make a change, make sure it's a calculated risk and you know what you're talking about, right? So yun. Anyways, I don't want to go back to that debate because there are these annoying bloggers, whatever people, whatever, nag-download lang na ibang journal article, akala niya, alam niya na yung lahat. No? But I'm not going to go to that. So in short, I am for reforms. Actually, for instance, para sa akin, 6 years is too long for a bad president and too short for a good president. I'd rather have 2 4-year or maybe 2 5-year like Indonesia if possible. No? So hindi ako agree. There are many things. I want enabling law sana for political dynasties. For some reason, the framers of 1987 constitution, hindi nila pinag-isipan yan. Naglagay sila ng constitution dyan. Tapos iniwan nila sa mga dynasties to pass a law against themselves. That's never gonna happen. It's not gonna happen. Like, it's ridiculous, right? So maraming problema sa ating saligang batas na kayang i-amend or baguhin na agree ako actually. So I'm not like one of those people na, no, let's stick with our constitution. No. I think our constitution should be also modified and changed depending on circumstances. No? So in theory, I'm okay. And actually, in theory, I like parliamentary a lot. Parang sarap maging prime minister, di ba? Than president, para mas social, di ba? Mas royal. But make sure we also have the foundations for that. No? Make sure meron kang good political parties, meron kang policy-oriented national discourse, a lot of those factors. And kung wala kang ganun, wala, you're just parliamentary in name, but in reality, it's just gonna be another form of presidential mess, right? So I think this is what. And then the other thing I noticed about us Filipinos is that when we have something, instead of making the most out of it, we want to get something new. Walang, kumbaga, walang follow through, di ba? So parang, bigyan ka ng kotse, instead of learning how to make the most of this car, ay, parang ayoko na, mabagal pala siya, bili ako ng bago. Parang, instead of pag-aralan mo, tignan mo yung brochure, adjust mo, improve mo yung engine niya, lagay mo ng extra, you know what I'm saying? Like, I'm giving you these metaphors to make you understand. Like, we already have an imperfect system, but that system can be improved, in my opinion. We can amend. I believe in amendment of our constitutions and making changes. Pero yung biglang, ay, tapon na lahat yan, bili tayo ng bagong kotse, kuha tayo ng bagong system, and then lahat maging ayos, that's nonsense. I'm sorry, that's nonsense. That's nonsense. So I, for a lot of leading academics in this country around the world, it's a joke for people to say, oh, if you just change it, what? Of course, there's some, you know, people there, but I don't want to go into that. But it's generally a joke. It's a monocausal explanation. And monocausal explanations tend to be a joke in social sciences. It just doesn't work. I mean, go ahead, write an academic book for a publisher, like, you know, my publishers, and do the monocausal. It's not going to pass the review process. It's not even going to pass the book proposal process, right? You can do that on blogs and all or political. In fact, meron ba kwento eh. Kay Chelito habito ko nakuha yan sa Inquirer because both of us are on the same page. So sometimes I read also his works. Parang my kampanya for Pepe, Federalism, right?
I think last before pandemic to. Tapos may taga DILG, baka may mga DILG na nandiyan. Anyways, and no problem. Frank si Sir Malay at si Sir Anyo, good friend. But there were folks in DILG daw na pupunta around the country. Nag-kampanya more or less for federalism, right? At nung tinanong sa kanya, Sir, ano makukuha natin sa federalism? Parang something like, maraming pagkain, apat na beses na pagkain sa isang araw. I mean, like, my God, anong kinalaman yan? Diba? But this is how the level of the debate is. Napakababaw yung level of debate. Sana we have a higher level, no? So, unfortunately, what we have is some bloggers just trolling you. I mean, honestly, I'll just magpo-post na ako ng parliamentary bad, biglang matroll ako. Like, that's not how you're supposed. We're supposed to have a proper debate. And I've written a lot on that. So please, just Google, Hey Darian, federalism, and dami lalabas dyan. So all the details, references are there. So I'm not going to go into detail on that because our discussion is more about leadership in general. But what I try to do here is that don't buy easy solutions because easy solutions tend to be the wrong solutions. It's like, alam mo yung mga advertisement na kuha mo, like, pag ano po, magiging milyonaryo ka, alam mo yung mga parang mga Ponzi scheme, yung mga, pag binili mo yan, binenta mo. It's like those advertisements you see online, yung mga, this guy will make you a millionaire in 10 days, yung mga ganun. Parang ganun yun. Wala, ay, yung mga easy solutions, they don't make sense. So, parang, alam mo yung Rubik's Cube, yung dapat lahat isang kulay, ganun. Parang ganun yun eh. If you want to solve a country's problem, you look at the problem, you see, eh, dito hindi tugma. Tapos isa-isahin mo hanggang tumugma lahat. Red dito, lahat green, lahat white. So, pag may nagsabi sa eh, ganun mo ng isa, lahat maging okay, hindi totoo yan because that's not how it works. Societies are like Rubik's Cube. You have to have multiple adjustments until you get exactly all green, white, and all na steady ka. So, if anyone gives you an easy solution, ay, one move lang, maayos mo yan, either wala siyang alam or he's may ulterior motive yan. Like the politician who asked me, Sir, pag federalism tayo, ano mga bago opisina ang bubukas sa provincial level? Alam mo na yan. I'm not gonna name names. Pero alam mo na yan. So I'll just keep it there, yeah.
Hey, thank you so much, Professor Hidarian. Yes, I also share the sentiment that instead of just rapidly changing the system, it would be better. If things are like, for instance, if it can be fixed, then why change it directly? So yeah, so I think that's there's another question. Miss Cha.
We have a question from one of our Zoom participants. So good afternoon, Sir Hidarian. Thank you for that fascinating and insightful lecture. I have heard from a lot of people we must reject the practices and beliefs of faith for the country to progress. How is this true? Should the practices of faith be suppressed in order to achieve progress in the country?
I don't know how to answer that because that sounds like an atheist, ultra-atheist argument. Maybe I'm misunderstanding it, but let me just put it this way. Barack Obama is a man of faith. Biden is a man of faith. Trump says he's a man of faith. I can name you a lot of global leaders who are men of faith. That has not in any way meant that they are not modern leaders. If anything, a lot of these people are men of faith, are actually also very effective leaders. I believe human beings, we need to have faith, but not to be fundamentalist, not to be intolerant, not to say that only our version is the truth and everyone else is false. That's Taliban, essentially, right? That's Taliban. Like, our version of the religion of this is this. Anyone who disagrees, you're infidels and all. That's where the problem comes in. Fanaticism is a problem, not faith. Faith is what makes life meaningful. If you have no faith, whether in a relationship, whether in a higher being, right? Walang direction ng buhay mo. Ano yan? Just to make yourself happy. I have more chocolates today. I have more cars. Walang saysay yung buhay na yan. You have to have faith. And there are going to be a lot of difficult times, very difficult times, when if you have no faith in God, you cannot survive it. You're going to go into drugs. You're going to go into all sorts of nasty, crazy things. Because we human beings are fragile. So you need faith. But a faith that brings compassion, a faith that brings true humility. Because if you accept there's a higher being than you, you're always going to question yourself in the right way. Hindi yung doubtful, ah, pero yung paano ko mali ako? Pag-aralan natin yan. Paano ko mali ako? Hinga ko na advice. Pero kung yabang mo, kala mo ikaw lang, hindi ka na advice, dyan tayo magkakamali. Stubborn men mostly get us into trouble. Again, speaking of Afghanistan, I think Biden was absolutely wrong on the timing and the way he exited. Why? He was stubborn.
He didn't listen to his advisors. He didn't listen to a lot of people. The idea was actually if you kept 3,000 to 5,000 American troops lang, even just in Kabul, the whole thing would still stick together. Because the soldiers and all would say, well, walang kwenta yung president namin, but at least andiyan yung mga Amerikano, they can send us reconnaissance flight. So it's still worth fighting for. Once they just, Americans just withdraw, abandon them. Ay, wala na to. Uwihan na. Yun ang nangyari, di ba? Stubborn si Biden eh. That's why disaster happens. Stubborn men, especially men, they bring disasters, no? That's why if you have humility, if you can say, yes, I may be old, I may have a lot of experience, but so what? Like, I'm just a human being. I can make a mistake. If you have faith, no, you can consult Bible, you can consult Quran, you can consult Torah, whatever religion is. Or if you're Buddhist, you meditate, you bring in oxygen, you get clarity, and then you make a decision, you have self-awareness, then you can be a good leader. Honestly, I'd rather vote for a leader who has a faith, who has faith in something bigger than himself. I rather wait. For me, it's a factor. Now, I'm not a religious fundamentalist. I won't say like just someone who's this religion or that. No, but someone who has a faith in a sense of my humility deep inside. So whether you're Muslim, you're Christian, you're Protestant, you're Catholic, you know, I will vote for you if I believe that you are a person who has humility and belief in it. Because I know you're going to be in a very difficult situation as a leader. And kung wala kang faith, you're going to fall apart. You're going to escape. You're going to be weak. You're going to be coward. Or you're going to be so arrogant. You're going to be like Nero, right? Like those bad, horrible emperors, tyrannical emperors who thought they're gods themselves, right? You're going to end up as either of the two. So I'd rather have a leader with faith. But fanaticism, yes, is the problem. It's a problem. And fanaticism is also political, right? Pag ganitong presidente, kahit anong gawin niya, kahit pumatay siya ng tao sa harap namin, mahal pa rin namin siya. Kahit yung pinakamadnanakaw sa mundo, mahal pa rin namin siya. Tapos sabay sabihin, ayoko sa corruption. Tapos biglang ang gusto mong presidente na fanatic ka or biglang napaka-corrupt na tao, anak ng napaka-corrupt na tao. Lahat problema yan. That's fanaticism. Nauuna yung manok mo kaysa yung interest ng bayan. No? The national interest should always come first. Then the president, then yung manok mo, ng partido mo. That's what... So I think that is what we have to keep in mind when we have discussions like this. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, Professor Hidarian. Here's another question from one of our Zoom participants. So in this digital age wherein fake news are found everywhere, in what way can we voters truly know the right leaders we should vote in this upcoming election?
Laking problema yan. Malaking problema yan in a sense that well, maybe invite more people like me and attend more Zoom talks like this. No, but aside from that, I mean, that's why mahal na mahal ko si Rizal eh. Tama talaga si Rizal ever since. Premature revolution, no, will make the slaves of yesterday the tyrants of tomorrow. If you want to have freedom and democracy, you need an educated population who's willing to take the time to fact check. Hindi yung nakita niyang unang-una dyan sa YouTube, ganun, maniwala na siya agad. I-fact check mo yan. I-Google mo lang yan. My God, ang dali mag-research nowadays. And then, check credibility. Ang dami ko nakita nagsisend ng link sa akin. Anong daw website na to? Pag tinignan mo, ginawa lang to last month. Or yung mga pangalan pala, napaka-dodgy or fake version ng BBC, obvious na fake. You know, like, people are lazy. I mean, many people are just lazy. Just don't be lazy. Just do a little bit research. The second thing is, we need legislation. We need to do something about it because freedom is not absolute. Kaya nga may libel tayo, di ba? Ano yung libel? Yung paninira na siraan mo yung hindi lang happiness, yung sinira mo yung isang family dahil nag-libel ka sa kanila, no? Or sinira mo yung business niya kasi sino nga? So if we have libel, that means constitutionally and legally, there is limitations to freedom. Freedom doesn't mean you can kill anyone or you can hurt anyone, you can destroy anyone. So there has to be legislation. But ang hirap ng problema na yun kasi may freedom of expression issue ka. There has to be a balance between freedom of expression and at the same time, responsible citizenship, right? And this is where, so I think there has to be a legislation, especially about troll farms. Because aminin natin, meron tayong troll farms. May mga tao na gumanda ang buhay, especially over the past 4 or 5 years, napakagandang buhay, biglang travel, kahit may pandemic, nag-New York, ang ganda ng kotse, biglang magarang. Dahil, troll farm. Dahil, yun nga, ang laki ng bayad eh. Diba? Nakita yung mga reports, yung mga, I think, entry level ng trolls, mga 25,000 ang kita, o, diba? Call center level, no? And in fact, we have reports to suggest that there's some call centers in Manila, in big cities, nagda-double time. Call center at night, troll farm morning. So, something has to be done about that because a democracy cannot survive in a cesspool of disinformation. Because to make responsible choices, you have to have a responsible discourse. And if there's no... Kasi itong problema eh. Napansin nyo, mas madali ma-share yung disinformation kaysa information. Kasi information is boring. And most people who do information are boring people. Yung magle-lecture lang. And disinformation, sensationalist, di ba? Alam ba si Sharon ganito? Alam ba si... You know what I'm saying? Like, it's so easy. In fact, there was a study by MIT that showed fake news travels 6 times faster. I mean, like, is shared 6 times more than real information. Because it's deliberately packaged in a sensationalist way that appeals to human nature, right? I mean, natin chismoso lahat ng tao. Lahat tayo chismoso. Lahat tayo, you know, may mga inis tayo na. So that's what disinformation, it plays into your prejudice and pagka-chismoso, your worst instincts, no? At marami sa atin tamad. Diba? Ba't ako mag-research dyan? Ito na eh. Diba? So, something has to be done. Adults have to step in. Some legislation has to happen. And let me tell you this way. This is a matter of national interest too. Because we have verified reports by the Facebook that elements in China have been spreading pro blank and blank running as president, as vice president next year. Right? So this was caught by Facebook last year. Based in China, having Facebook groups of pro this and that person who we very well know in this country, right? For the next elections. So we already have foreign elements, potentially from hostile country, who want to create divisions and problems in our country by pushing their own manok. No? So if you don't do something about it, you're going to have a problem. And let me give you an example. Taiwan, which is a democracy, actually has anti-influence legislation. Australia, which is a democracy, has an anti-influence inquiry. So they have legislations that target this, yung mga disinformation from abroad, especially yung mga proxies nila, to create mess in the country. Because if we don't do something about it, I don't know, maging garapala ng discussion, national discussion natin. Like anything goes, di ba? So this is a problem. Unfortunately, in recent years, we have had some people in power who actually benefit from disinformation. So wala akong expectation from them to deal with it. But hopefully the next president will do something about this because ang laking problema yan. Because I'll just be honest with you, like the problem with disinformation is that you get tempted to fight them with fire. No? So kung kayo puno paninira, eh paano kayo labanan? Panira din ako. The whole level of discussion goes down. The whole level of discussion goes on. So this is my expression, no? Diba? They usually say, if you can beat them, join them. Well, pagdating sa disinformation, I think their philosophy is, if you cannot beat them, smear them. No? So kung hindi mo matalo yung credentials, yung argument, siraan mo siya. Gawa ka ng story. Ay, ano to? Ahente to ng ibang bansa. Or hindi ito Pilipino. Or itong... Yan ang ginagawa nila eh. They cannot beat you, they'll smear you. And I can tell you from personal experience that buti nga makapal ang mukha ako, no? So medyo makapal ang mukha ako. So I, you know, hindi ako na-intimidate. But there are a lot of people who are saying, ayoko na mag-comment kasi mag-comment ka lang konti, ang dami mong gaaway sa sisiraan ka. Huwag na lang. So you become disinterested. And what happens is that when citizens are disinterested in politics, trapos and their minions will win the game. Kasi sila lang may pera organize. So few people can dominate millions of people. If millions of people are discouraged from entering political discourse because of disinformation, harassment, and everything like that. So you need, that's why faith matters. Because if you have faith in truth, if you have faith in God, you know that, you know, Jesus Christ, all of, you know, great leaders in history, they faced maraming maninira sa kanila, di ba? Because they were saying the truth. And truth hurts if you're a bad person, if you're doing a bad thing, right? But if you have faith, you will persevere. So good leaders have to have faith. Dahil if you're actually automatically kung good leader ka, you're gonna be in danger. You're gonna be in danger. That's the sad story of our times. Good leaders will face a lot of enemies because bad people tend to benefit from status quo. When a country is poor and divided, the beneficiaries are bad people, right? And bad means corrupt, incompetent, so on and so forth, right? Not in a good and bad, good and evil way. No one is evil. No one is perfectly good. We're all human beings. We can improve. We can deteriorate. But there are people who unfortunately benefit from bad situation of the country than a good situation in the country. That's just a reality. Because when a country